Radio TV Phono Nut here, and let me start off by apologizing for the length of this video. I normally don't make videos this long, in fact nowhere near this long, and when I had the old camera I was only good for about 8 minutes before I had to dump the camera, but with this new camera I'm good for about 47 minutes before I have to dump the camera, so I end up rambling on and taking up a lot more time than I normally would have with the old camera, and I get so caught up in things that I don't even realize how long I'm filming. So in the future I will try to do a better job at working on that. I know 3.5 hours is way excessive for a video. I'll try to keep them around an hour, maybe an hour and a half. If I have to go any longer, then we'll split it up into two parts. But I'm going to give you a brief rundown over as far as what was done to this radio, so you'll kind of know what's going on, and in case you want to skip around, and I certainly won't blame you for doing so. So what we have here is a Coronado, which was the house brand for Gamble's department store, battery operated Tombstone farm radio that's capable of receiving the standard broadcast and the shortwave band. I'd say this is from about 1935 or 36, and this is one of the better playing battery operated tube radios that I've ever owned.
Tell us.
Well, yeah, so the Big Ten gets the deal, and it's very much...
We're praised, 95.9 FM, 9:10 AM.
The Bible declares that he has raised us up to...
pro-friendly model, which...
South in Crimea, Russian authorities said local air defense is shot.
Playoff wind up in that model too, to be on multiple channels. But he was on Real Sports recently with Brian Gumbel.
This thing still got a little bit of distortion in the audio, and I think improper bias voltages that I'm using has a little bit to do with that. Everything else has pretty much been gone over. Now, I'll briefly go over here and tell you what all we did to this. First off, I goofed up by trying to find the proper schematic for this radio and riders, and I ended up with the wrong schematic to start with. And because I wasn't paying close enough attention, using the wrong schematic sort of sent me on a wild goose chase, especially when it came to aligning this radio. I finally found the proper schematic and was able to align it correctly, but as far as getting the chassis to work, all of the capacitors were leaky, very leaky. A couple of them were so bad to the point that they was preventing the radio from operating, and we demonstrate troubleshooting techniques in the video to find those. The speaker that was originally used in this was an old style magnetic reed type with a center tapped high impedance voice coil. No output transformer, just a push-pull audio output stage directly driving the speaker. Well, unfortunately the voice coil was open in that speaker, so for the time being we have a 6x9 speaker and a universal push-pull audio output transformer in place to substitute for the original speaker. I'll be on the lookout for an original type speaker, and if I can find one I'll put it in here. However, I can tell you that this 6x9 speaker is gonna sound way better than the primitive magnetic reed speaker that was originally in this radio. So on that note, I'm really not in any hurry to replace the speaker in this with an original type. Might just leave it just like it is. To power this radio, we need 3 volts for the filament, we need 135 volts B+, we need a negative 22 volts and a negative 4.5 volts for bias voltage for the tube grids, and I'm getting most of those voltages from this cruddy, well-used, beat-up power supply kit that I built from Antique Electronics Supply. We're getting our 4.5 volts from these 3 batteries that we have wired in series that are pretty weak, so I'm not actually getting 4.5 volts here, more like 3 volts. And the 22 volt supply that this battery eliminator delivers unloaded is being loaded down to about 15 or 16 volts with the radio connected to it. So really that bias supply is really not stout enough for this radio. And I'll talk more about that in the video. Playing the radio down in the shop, we don't have any modulation hum. However, when I brought it up here to the patio, we had modulation hum, and that's hum that can only be heard when you're tuned to a radio station, also known as tunable hum. And the way I solved that problem was to temporarily connect a 0.047 capacitor between one side of the AC power line and the radio's chassis, which serves as ground for the A, B, and C supplies. So for those who say the line bypass capacitor in AC operated radios does nothing and needs to be removed from the circuit, well, you would be wrong, because that line bypass capacitor is often what prevents modulation hum, and without that capacitor you may get modulation hum. So in an AC operated set that uses that capacitor, you need to keep that capacitor in place. It generally connects between one side of the power line and the chassis, whether it be a transformer operated set or an AC/DC set. Alright, so once again, I apologize for the length of this video. I just wanted to give you a brief heads up as to what all was done to this. And you're probably asking, why did that take 3.5 hours? Well, I don't even remember myself. So if you want to skip around in the video, then obviously I understand. But I just wanted to let you know what we did to this. And if you're up for it, sit back and enjoy the long ride here. Radio TV Phono Nut here, and we have a big honking Coronado, which was a house brand for Gamble's Scogmo department store. This is a battery operated set, and I believe it receives the standard AM broadcast band and the shortwave band. And now we'll turn it around and look at the back. Here's the inside, lots of empty space here, and they made these battery operated sets in large cabinets for a reason, so you'd have a place to conceal the batteries so the lady of the house wouldn't get annoyed by batteries being visible everywhere. See, we have a magnetic speaker, pin drive type speaker, which was common for battery sets in the 30s. And I believe we have a push-pull audio output stage with actually two triodes within the same envelope. And this back here, I believe, is our interstage transformer. And this thing requires a number of different voltages. Our battery cable looks to be in pretty good shape and still has the metal tags on each lead telling you what goes where. These two leads here, I suspect, are the antenna and ground leads. So we require a negative 4.5 volts C voltage, and then we require 135 volts B plus, and that's our B minus. And this one here is A plus, which is probably 2 volts. And we have another C minus 22 volts, and then our A minus. So quite a few voltages there that we need to come up with. Now let's go see if we can find a schematic for this joker. On the model tag it says made in plant B, Chicago, Illinois. And I bet you this was actually made by Belmont Radio Corporation. This thing sort of has a Belmont look to it. And they built a lot of sets for department stores. Alright, let's see if I can... What is that? 7735CO? I need to go look that up and see what I can come up with. Well, I misspoke. I was re-watching the video footage, and this radio was made in Plant S, not Plant B. It's amazing how much clearer you can see things when looking at the video on a enlarged screen. All right, we have our Rider Perpetual Troubleshooter's Manual, Volume 7, which supposedly this radio is covered in this book. I have a pretty good selection of these printed Rider manuals at the time of this video. I think I'm missing volumes 18, 21, and 23. And 23 was the last one, which unfortunately seems to be a pretty elusive volume. And when it does show up, it's usually expensive. The rest of them are usually fairly easy to find. You just have to be patient and wait it out. Alright, let's see if we can find this radio in here. Okay, I believe this is the schematic we seek. We have a converter tube, a first IF amp, a second IF amp, a detector tube, a pre-driver tube, a driver tube, and then a push-pull audio output tube. It's two triodes in the same envelope with an interstage transformer coupling the driver stage to the output stage. And you may be asking, why do you want to keep all these printed riders when you can get all of that off of the internet? And there are various people selling DVDs that contain the whole set on one disc. Well, yeah, it's convenient to have on the computer, but some of those scans on the computer are not very easy to read. And also, what if I get tired of paying the internet? Or what if the computer goes down, or some kind of something happens where I don't have access to the digital files? Then I've got the old printed books to fall back on. And of course, fortunately, everybody doesn't feel like that the way I do. That's why these Rider manuals are worth less now than they were 30 years ago. So I just wait till they come up cheap, and when I see one for sale cheap that I don't have, I buy it. And like I said, I'm only missing 18, 21, and 23. And I've got the Beatman Most Often Needed Radio Repair Schematic Series 2. I think the only ones I'm missing out of that one are the years 1963 and 64, but I've got the rest of them from 1926 through 1969, so. All right, let's get the chassis out of this Coronado and see what we can do with it. Now, one other thing, this set does not use an audio output transformer. This uses a high impedance speaker. As you can see, it has a center tapped voice coil. So that's how they're able to do that. Now, if this speaker was trashed, in which it may be, we don't know yet. But if for some reason this speaker had to be replaced, we could replace it with a conventional PM speaker and a matching transformer, and the radio would work just fine. And I like the fact that the speaker unplugs. It makes it easier to get everything apart, and it also shows that they weren't into extreme cost cutting. Now, if they were into extreme cost cutting, the speaker would be hardwired to the chassis, and it would be more difficult to get everything out here. Here's the speaker, and the cone looks to be in great shape. Let's try to keep it that way if we can. Now, electrically, we don't know what kind of shape it's in yet. How it's going to sound, we won't know that until we get it all fixed up. But these kind of speakers generally don't sound as good as a conventional PM speaker, a modern PM speaker. And also, these battery-operated radios don't have the power output that an AC-operated set would have, so you're not going to get the volume level or the tonal quality that you would get out of an AC-operated set, but they're still decent enough radios when they're working right. And it looks like this speaker was made by Utah Orthovox. And I like how these old components have well-designed labels on them that's pleasing to look at, even in many cases, things like capacitors and other under-chassis components. Even though they're not generally seen, they still have nice graphics on them, and that's something we don't have anymore. On today's parts, you get an ink stamp on the part or some kind of printed label, and that's it. No fancy graphics. And we're off to a bad start already. I'm checking across the center tap coil on this speaker, and I'm not getting any resistance whatsoever, so we have an open coil apparently. We will look into this and try to repair it if we can, but I'm not holding my breath expecting that to happen. So what's probably going to happen is we're going to end up finding a more modern PM speaker and adding an impedance matching transformer. I was really worried when I saw this rust on the speaker here, because that tells us that this thing's been in some moisture, and moisture generally doesn't go well with these things, especially when the windings are as thin as what's used in here. They corrode and break very easily. Looking at the bottom, we have all four chassis mounting screws that look to be matching, so that's a plus. Maybe this thing hasn't been monkeyed with too much. All right, chassis has been removed, some rust on the chassis, so this thing was either stored in a damp environment or some rodent has been in here pissing all over it. And with old radios like this, any of the two are highly possible. All right, let's flip the bottom up and see what it looks like. We'll both see it for the first time. All right, looks about typical under here. Doesn't look like it's been messed with too terribly bad. And of course, we'll want to check the coils and the transformers and all that good stuff and make sure none of them are bad, because if mice or rats have been in here pissing, and then it's possible that other things could have open windings, and if too much is wrong with this, then this is not going to get fixed. It'll be something that goes up on the Facebook baby clothes and cell phone pages for $5 or $10 as a non-functional display item, and that'll be that. But you know how it is, for such a high price of $5 or $10, they would expect it to be 100% restored and fully working, but unfortunately it doesn't work that way. And the tuning is gear driven, so no string to break, thank goodness. Now it looks like this radio has an extra tube. It's not shown on the schematic. We have this that looks like a ballast tube, likely used as some sort of a voltage regulator. Another thing you want to watch out for on any battery-operated tube radio is make sure the tube filaments are not open. I've seen quite a few over the years where someone would miswire the batteries and end up blowing the tubes open. I pulled a few out of this one and checked the filaments, and they seem to have continuity, so that's okay. Had this radio had a set of blown tubes, it would have gone right back in the cabinet, and that would have been the end of it. I've checked the continuity of the speaker cable from the plug here to these three connecting points on the speaker, and that's all good. Right now I'm clipped across the winding, and as you can see, an open circuit. Now I'm clipped across half of the winding, and as you can see, an open circuit. And clipped across the other half of the winding, and as you can see, an open circuit. And I'm sure the break is the center tap where the B plus goes in. All right, reading across the secondary winding of the interstage transformer, I'm reading 779 ohms. That seems about right. Reading from center tap to one side of the secondary winding, I get 405 ohms. And the other side I get 373 ohms, so there's a little bit of imbalance there, but that's often the case with these types of transformers, so we're not going to worry about that. As long as it's not open or the imbalance is way off, we're not going to worry about it. Now, reading across the primary side of the interstage transformer, which is the plate side, we're reading almost 1200 ohms, which is probably okay, but like I said, I'm just mainly looking for a reasonable continuity or an open circuit. And for right now, we're going to call this reasonable. These interstage transformers are also bad about opening up, especially on older 1920 sets. I think by the 30s, they got a little more advanced. But when you have a winding that reads as high as this one does, then that tells me you have a lot of turns of very, very fine wire wrapped around the core of this transformer. And the finer the wire, the more likely it is to end up getting damaged from things like corrosion and varmints chewing on it and that sort of thing. Now, I think the next thing we need to do is get this speaker on the bench and try to repair it. Really, nothing ventured, nothing gained here, so if we mess it up, we just mess it up. It's certainly not usable in its current state. Now, there's a good chance this radio played whenever it was put into storage. Many of these battery sets were functioning perfectly fine when the owners received electric lines, and then the old battery radio went into storage and forgotten about for the next 70 or 80 years, 60, 50 years, however long. And the reason they didn't throw it away, because back then people didn't have the throwaway mentality like they have now. These folks back then grew up during the Great Depression, where things were hard to come by, and even if something was no longer needed at that particular moment, they didn't just throw it away. They stuck it back somewhere just in case it was needed one day, and then a lot of times it never was needed and it was just forgotten about, and then it got dug out when everybody passed away and all their stuff got sold off or given away or whatever, and then the stuff wound up for sale. All right. Let's start taking screws out of this thing and see what I can come up with. Here's the terminal board removed. Now, the first order of business is to unsolder this and recheck everything, because sometimes these old solder connections get compromised and they just need to be redone. I don't imagine we'll get that lucky here, but you never know. I just added some solder to these connections here to no avail, so now we're going to unsolder everything and go from there. I was hoping that I could just add a little of the S word to that, and maybe if there was something not making contact, it would now make contact, but it couldn't be that simple. Alright, I have the wires disconnected from the terminal board and I'm not getting any continuity still, so this is not looking good for the home team here. So most likely it's broken at the center there where the two halves of the winding join. I'm doing something very unorthodox, and this is a long shot, but I have the suicide cord connected across the entire winding. We're plugged into the dim bulb tester to limit the current, and we're going to apply AC voltage and see if possibly the brake will arc back together. While I tap on this, and I doubt anything's going to happen. Nope, nothing's happening except we're rolling stuff off the workbench with all the vibration. And as expected, we're still wide open on the meter. So we're going to remove more screws, get this thing apart, and see if there's any break anywhere that I can possibly repair. And you can see rusty, corrosive stuff here, so it stands to reason that most likely what happened is some rodent urinated in this thing, and it leaked down in here and corroded the wire and broke it off, and that was that. Okay, we're getting there as far as taking this speaker apart. Well, a piece fell off down into the abyss, but I really don't think there's any need in trying to find it, because here's your coil wrapped around in here, and I checked all the way back to here and I'm still getting an open, and there's just no way I can get all this out and deal with that little bitty fine wire. So I think this radio is going to be seeing a more modern PM speaker and an audio output transformer in its future. I really hate it, but that's the way it goes sometimes. This screw here, I was going to take this off, but this screw here is so stuck, I just can't get it off. And likely because of all the corrosion and rat piss that got down in there and has it stuck like Chuck. See, I've read where 70 volt line transformers for PA use make a suitable audio output transformer for these types of radios, and they'll actually work on several different impedance requirements. I know for best results the battery tubes require an output transformer of a different impedance than what you would normally find in an AC operated set, so we'll just have to look at the tube manual for the type of tube being used in that set, see what the impedance is, and go from there. I've looked on eBay and the internet, and I found some options for an output transformer and a speaker. I'm going to try to find a speaker that has the holes on it where a transformer can be mounted, but I realize that might be sort of a tall order. If I can't find such a thing, I'll just have to mount the transformer under the chassis, but I'm probably going to use a 70 volt line transformer. But before we do all that, we're going to use our signal tracer, which happens to have a built-in test speaker and audio output transformer that is center tapped that can be used for push-pull circuits. The impedance of that particular transformer probably won't be ideal for this battery radio output stage, but it'll be good enough for testing the chassis. And once we get the chassis to play, then we'll worry about ordering a speaker and a new transformer. And another thing that could have burned the coil open on the original speaker is one of these plate bypass capacitors. If one of them shorted, then that would draw B plus through the speaker coil to ground, and that could burn it open, especially if left on for any length of time. But I'll check that as I'm working on the radio, but I'm more inclined to think that what killed that speaker was moisture and rat piss. I've installed new connectors on the end of this battery cable that will make it easier to connect to the power supply that this will ultimately be connected to, whether that be a battery pack or an AC supply, but it'll have screw type terminals on it, and this will make things much easier. And here's our signal tracer, an old ICO signal tracer, and if you can see here, we have connections here for the output transformer, B plus in the center, one plate connection on the left, one plate connection on the right for push pull, and that way we can just utilize the output transformer inside the signal tracer and the speaker to listen to the radio chassis on. And then once we get the radio working, then we can procure a more proper speaker for this thing. And if we don't get it working for whatever reason, then we won't have to worry about procuring a proper speaker and output transformer for this. And I had the speaker leads from the radio connected to the signal tracer. I just have the wire sticking in the holes there. I need to update those jacks to some banana jacks, which are more common than to find plugs for than the old style pin plugs like what these jacks are. And we have all this rat's nest connected up. This radio requires 2 volts A for the filaments, 135 volts B plus. And what else does it require? 4.5 volts C, 22 volts C, and this thing, I just don't like all these voltages that are required. I like the newer sets that require 1.5 and 90, and that's it. I saw something on the schematic that says it also requires 90 volts B plus, but I can't find a lead for that. And I'm using 2 C-cell batteries for the lower C voltage. I know it requires 4.5, but 3 ought to work. So we're going to plug this up and turn it on, see if it makes any noise or blows up or whatever. This is one of those sets where I'd almost just put it back together and just sit it up on the shelf and look at it. All right, let's turn it on and see what happens. Well, we had a large current spike and then it dropped down to 0. So what smoked? Something smoked. I smell something burning. What is it? Well, this transistor on my power supply is running red hot. So what shorted and blew up? I'm just really not in the mood for this. I'm just about ready just to put this back together, put it on the Facebook baby clothes and cell phone pages for $10 and tell them you worry about fixing it, or just use it for a shelf queen. Well, I'm still getting voltage out of my power supply, so apparently I didn't destroy it. But either I connected something wrong with this radio, or something's wired wrong, these tags are not labeled right, or something. And it's stuff just such as this is the reason these types of old battery radios have basically 0 collector value. Most people want something that they can just plug into an AC outlet and use, and not something they have to deal with all these connections and worrying about a power supply and all that stuff. I mean, yeah, when you're a radio restoration person and already have a power supply, that's one thing, but you know, the average person doesn't want to be bothered with all this. Alright, B plus 90 volts, and that goes into the primary winding of the interstage transformer. And I think that's the only thing that utilizes that 90 volt supply. Well, on this one, they look to be running everything off of the 135 volt line. So I'm starting to think my schematic may not actually be the schematic for this radio chassis, and this doesn't look like something under here that was changed. That looks like it was soldered that way from the factory. See, on this one we have C, 4.5 volts. C looks like 3, and then C plus, A minus, and B minus all connect directly to chassis ground. And then we have our B plus 90 volts or 112 volts, and they mentioned to get more volume out of it, use 112 volts. That's what goes up to the driver stage. And then we have 135 volts, and what is this over here that I can't see? That's our A plus, which is 2 volts, that goes up to the off on switch and then to all the tube heaters. Okay, in this case they have the A minus switched, whereas on the schematic the A plus is switched. All right, A plus connects to this pin on this ballast tube, which is not shown on the schematic. Now, by the way, the model number on the riders is just 77. The model number of this radio is what, 7735 something or another? Well, I looked up the radio's model number on the Radio Museum website, and it said that this particular rider schematic was the proper one for this chassis, but I'm starting to think that it may not be. All right, I've got my A connected, and I'm getting 1.8 volts on the filaments of the tubes, and we're going to leave it at that for now. I'm sure this ballast tube is what's bringing it slightly down from the 2 volts that I had the power supply set to. So like I said, we'll leave it for now. I'm just going to reconnect everything up one stage at a time and just see where we are with this. All right, we're going to try it one more time. I have everything connected but the 4 volts C voltage. Let's see what happens. Voltage hum in the speaker and the current fluctuating all over the place. Transistor run is hot, running hot as hell. Okay, I disconnected the audio output transformer and I'm checking the B plus at the center tap that would go to the transformer, and it's there. But whenever I connect the transformer, something shorts out and it's overheating my power supply. I'm not detecting any short circuit when I check from the center lead of this cable here to ground, but that doesn't mean anything. We could have something shorting out when voltage hits it. Okay, the schematic shows a capacitor going from each plate of the output tube to ground. This chassis tells another story. It only has one capacitor connected between one plate and the other plate of the audio output tube. All right, now I'm getting B plus here, but my transistor is still running hot as Hades on here, and I'm about to the point of turning this thing on, and if it blows up, it blows up. I'm just about to the point of this radio just being a shelf queen, because quite frankly, I'm not in the mood to deal with all of this. And of course there's no stations as I tune across the dial. Why would there be? Well, it looks like our audio stage is working. So that's good. So maybe there was something going on with the bias supply. My connections might not have been that great or something. I don't know, that was causing the tubes to run away with themselves and cause my power supply to overheat. I know we're not drawing near as much current as we were. All right, so we're turned wide open. I'm getting no clickage whenever I turn the... band switch or anything. Okay, the audio circuit is working, obviously, but everything else is totally dead. I'm not getting any hint of a radio station. All right, I have the signal generator tuned to 455 kilocycles, the IF frequency. I have it turned wide open and I'm blowing a signal directly into the IF amplifier tube, and as you can tell, we're not hearing anything out of the speaker, so we have a dead stage here, or maybe more than one dead stage. One thing I'm interested in is this can ohm resistor here. The input side of it connects to the negative 22 volt C supply. And then these other taps, I presume, are various bias takeoff points for various points in the radio. These are very bad about opening, so we're going to check the voltage on all of these points and make sure they're there. Because if we don't have a proper bias voltage, that means we have a stage that's not going to work. Or maybe more than one stage that's not going to work. Okay, so this is our voltage input. The extreme other end connects to the chassis. So this is like a voltage divider here. So we should have voltage here, of course, on the input, and then here and here. If we have it on the input and nothing here and or nothing here, then we have an open resistor. All right, so what do we have here? Negative 15 volts. Should be 22 volts. Something's loading it down. What do we have up here? make contact, if you would. Negative 6.9 volts. That's good. At least we have something there. All right, what do we have here? Negative 1.5 volts. So I'm inclined to believe this resistor is probably okay. Well, I don't know what happened, but I just heard a station and then it faded out into oblivion. We have a bad connection somewhere. I'll bet we have a leaky coupling capacitor in the audio chain. Right on the control grid of this second driver tube, I have 3 volts positive. So this capacitor is leaky. So this coupling capacitor couples the plate of the first audio tube to the control grid of the second audio tube. We'll just refer to it as that, just for simplicity's sake. And then we have the interstage transformer that couples the second audio tube to the final push-pull audio output tube. Now, I don't know what was going on with this. I don't know why we couldn't blow a signal through this with a signal generator. I'm just happy that we were finally able to get a station to come in. That tells us that pretty much all of the major organs are good. So that's a good thing. But what's happening now, we turn the radio on and an obsessive amount of current is drawn for a few seconds and then it settles back down. And that very well could be this capacitor that's very leaky and causing this driver tube to overconduct and just pull too much current. And as far as this power supply goes, I need to quit talking about it and just do it, but I want to mount this in some kind of enclosure and have binding posts on the enclosure where I can make easy connections. I also want to add another power supply in the mix for C voltage, because this one only provides 1 C voltage, whereas many radios such as this one require 2 C voltages, so we need to make provisions for that. All right, I want to lift the grid end of this capacitor and turn it on and see what happens. All right, we have the grid end of that capacitor lifted. Now I want to power this up and see if the current spikes at turn on, and then I want to check the DC voltage at the end of this capacitor under no load and see what it is. So let's see what happens here. Well, it came up a tad bit like I would expect and fell back down, but it did not rise up and slowly come back down. All right, let's see what we have on this capacitor. We have 122 volts on the end of that capacitor. So that capacitor is, for all intents and purposes, shorted. All right, this 0.01 capacitor reads 0.046, 0.047 on the meter. Overachiever? No, just a very leaky capacitor that's taking a lot longer to charge than what a 0.01 would normally take, thus confusing the meter and making it think that it's a lot larger of a capacitor than it really is. It's not measuring any capacitance on the meter here. All right, ready to see a neon light illuminate? Oh yeah, even at the lowest voltage, you can see how leaky it is. Blinking just means leaky. When it's constantly illuminated, that's pretty much, for all intents and purposes, a short. All right, caps in, let's see what happens. Well, I need to hook my wires back up. They fell out. All right, take 2.
Knowing your home is covered, these agents will put you first. That's what's happening. Ramsey Trusted. To check your home insurance with a trusted ELP, visit RamseySolutions.com/home.
Alright, the volume's lower, but it's still distorted as all get out. Alright, we've now got negative 5 volts on the control grid of the second audio tube. That's what we should have. Moving back to the plate of the first audio tube. I've got 125 volts. That seems pretty reasonable.
And as I'm wondering if I should take my money with me or leave it with my company. And if I take it with me,
I've got what looks like 12 volts on the screen grid. That may be low. All right, on the other side of that screen dropping resistor, I've got 61 volts. That seems to be a bit low too. Let's see where that goes on the schematic. Now that shows this resistor on the schematic is going back to the 135 volt B plus source, but that's not where it goes in this radio. But we've already determined that the schematic and riders does not appear to match this particular radio. Alright, it comes up here and goes to what looks like the screen grid of the IF amplifier tube, and then up to the screen grid of the converter tube, and then we have, that looks like an 18K resistor connected to that, going back to an electrolytic filter cap. Let's check the voltage on the input side of that resistor and see what it is. Alright, let's see what we have here. We have 130 volts on that side of on the input side of that resistor. Alright, this one up here is measuring 20K. It's 18K, it's marked value, so that's not a problem. And this one down here is a 500K, and it's measuring like 75K in circuit, so a good bit lower than normal. I'm going to pull it loose and see what it is out of circuit. Okay, out of circuit, I'm reading 537K, so that resistor is perfectly fine. And I'm checking this big screen bypass capacitor with an ohm meter, although that doesn't account for much. And we're not reading anything, but that doesn't mean that it's not shorting out under load and pulling our voltage down. I've lifted one end of the screen bypass cap for the first audio tube, and we're about to apply power. And it may squeal like a stuck pig because that's an RF bypass capacitor, but I want to see if the voltage rises at all from the 12 volts that I was getting there. But first, we might better connect our connections back up to the signal tracer to keep falling out. All right, let's see what happens.
Is a personal finance expert with Tally. She has some tips if you are looking to buy a home.
Think about what you can do to be the...
Well, it got a lot louder and clearer, didn't it?
If you're paying high interest credit
cards, I bet that voltage...
Think about how you can improve that, because that'll improve your credit score, which gets you a better mortgage rate. So look to resources like Tally is a great one to help you pay down your...
Well, it didn't rise that much, but it rised a little bit, up to 20 volts.
...being recalled over possible contamination.
So it's obvious this guy here is bad.
...for Capri Sun Wild Cherry Flavored Juice...
You see, whenever I touch it to the chassis, it goes away.
...have led to an investigation.
When I raise the lift the connection...
...the sentencing trial of Parkland, Florida shooter Nicholas Cruz is being delayed until...
So yeah, when I lift the connection, our audio comes back. So let's get that capacitor out and replace it. Wait a minute, this looks like a two-in-one capacitor. One over here, and one going to the screen grid. What pin is this, I wonder? Okay, that other side must be a filament bypass, which is also the cathode. These are directly heated tubes in this set, which means the filament and the cathode are one and the same. That's the reason they come to life almost instantly when power is applied.
80.
All right, I've eliminated the filament end of that capacitor, and I'm going to retouch the ground connection and see if the audio goes away. I want to see what side of that capacitor was causing the trouble. The filament bypass or the screen bypass. It's obvious the screen side is leaky because it rose up to from 12 to 19 volts when I disconnected it. So let's see what happens here.
30? Okay. How long you been working on it?
Oh, get out of the way, you piece of wire. You're interfering with progress here.
Emergency fund about 1.5 years.
Right, I found a clip lead. This will be simpler.
Basically, if I step back to 3 feet.
Yep, it's the screen bypass side that's causing the problem. All right, this is a dual 0.1 at 200 volts, and I think our battery is fixing to die. All right, this solar seal tight is very leaky, so as Mr. Carlson often says, seal tight to keep the leakage in. Okay, so two capacitors were really wreaking havoc on this radio. The first one was the plate-to-grid coupling cap for the between the first audio tube and the second audio tube. And then the second capacitor was the
and we have two ways
screen bypass
online,
cap for the
and clicking on the send
second audio tube. Or excuse me, the first audio tube. But since that was a dual cap, with one capacitor being on the filament slash cathode bypass for said tube, which, by the way, that cap is not shown on the schematic. Just went ahead and replaced both of them. Now, all of these capacitors need to go. But we know that we can probably safely do that now that the radio is playing, and that tells us that all the major organs are good. This thing has got an unusually high amount of volume for a battery radio.
God-fearing, law-abiding Mike Gallagher Show listeners can spare $100 to send literally, I mean... football division. How many lives save? Please go to mikeonline.com. Click on the send food banner at the top of the page. And I am praying without ceasing that God will touch 100 listeners' hearts today. And whatever you can afford, maybe it's $5, maybe
and
it's
this 10. Thing has better tonal quality than your average battery set too, so that's good. I might have to eat my words about what I said earlier in the video that these battery sets don't have the tonal quality or the power that an AC set has, and generally they don't, but this one here might be an exception. All right, I just changed the volume control coupling capacitor, and I think that cleared it up a bit. I also changed the tone control capacitor.
WMOX.
Now this set has a three-position tone control switch, but only two positions are utilized, the high and low position.
A huge level of conservatism. I think she's going to be a woman without a party. There's really no party that Liz Cheney is going to be welcome in at this point.
I don't think the American people hate President Biden.
That's
I
low.
Certainly don't. But I think a majority of the voters in our country at this juncture think he would be better off selling catheters on late night TV than serving as President of the United States.
Yeah, I tend to
from
agree.
The ReliefFactor.com studios, here's
I don't know that he'd make a good catheter salesman.
Through a time when we think it can't get any more shocking. But I'm not sure how crazier it could be than to witness the raid of the 45th president of the United States.
And they use a 0.01 microfarad cap for the tone circuit, which is a good balance. It cuts off a little bit of the high end, but it doesn't cut off so much of the high end that you lose volume.
Donald Trump Jr., of course, is a loss. Your mom passing away a few weeks ago, and wow, what a life.
Yeah, we got Don Jr. on here. I better not let too much of that play. YouTube might can my channel for airing hate speech.
And again, our condolences for the loss of your mom.
And of course, who knew that weeks later you'd be on a radio show being interviewed by somebody who'd say to you, they took your dad's passports? Don, they took his passports?
They took his passports, they took his picture books. You know, we've been lied to about the genesis of all of this, right? First, Merrick Garland didn't know anything about it. Then it turned out he personally signed off. Now it turns out he's been looking at it for weeks. People don't buy
you remember
it anymore,
that screen grid voltage on this first audio tube? It was 12 volts.
It's supposed to be a very detailed warranty.
Before we replaced that severely leaky capacitor, and then it came up to 19.8 volts and started playing after we replaced. Well, once we clip this capacitor loose,
they're looking for anything. What they're trying to do is they're
creeped up to about 30 volts. So it's
him from running again because they know he's the only person in the entire Republican Party that would have the guts to try to actually dismantle and take.
Signed off.
And I just tested these two capacitors,
which evidently allowed them.
One of them out of the tone circuit, and the other one the coupling cap between the volume control and the first audio tube, and as expected, both of them are very leaky, just like all the remaining ones in this set will probably be. Oh yeah, and by the way, this stuff, which by the way is my spool of solder, is getting expensive too. Like anywhere between 40 and 60 bucks for a pound of this Keister rosin core solder. And yes, there is cheaper stuff out there, but like the counterfeit parts, I'm a little bit skeptical about buying off-brand solder off of eBay because you never know what you're getting. However, I do look on there for older solder and try to look for deals. So I found three spools of 1 pound rosin core solder for 30-something dollars, look like older stuff, made in USA. So I ordered that, but yeah, everything's getting more expensive, not just solder, everything. It's like I was looking for a suitable output transformer to go with whatever speaker that I'm going to mate with this radio, and I looked up the output tube for this radio, and whereas like a 50L6 or something has a load impedance of something like, what, about 4,500 ohms. This type 19 tube has a load impedance, requires a load impedance of around 10,000 ohms. And that's pretty typical for battery tubes. And I mean, yes, a transformer with a lower impedance will work, but it's best to try to match the impedance as best you can. So Antique Electronics Supply sells a Hammond Universal Replacement Push-Pull Audio Transformer. It's about 40-something bucks, and that's probably what I'm going to end up going with. But yeah, the point I'm trying to make is all of these people, when you try to sell something, expect to get something for 10 or 15 bucks and it be in perfect working condition. Well, that's really impossible in today's world because parts are not cheap anymore. Whereas 50 or 60 years ago, that audio transformer would have been no more than $5. Now it's $45 plus shipping. And that's because parts like that are a specialty item now. They're not cranked out by the millions. There's not a high demand for them like there was 60 years ago. And therefore, the price is going to be higher. So, but it's one of those cases, what do? You know, if you want to fix the radio correctly, then you up the bucks and buy the part. If you don't, then just forget about it and keep it as a shelf queen. And while we're on the subject of money, I read something on one of the Facebook groups the other day that didn't sit well with me. It was on the stereo and hi-fi group. Actually, it wasn't the other day, it was a few weeks ago, and it was some guy making a post that went somewhere along the lines of, I'm on disability and on a fixed income, and I need somebody to give me a free vintage stereo receiver in excellent working condition. Now, let me say, I understand the guy's position. I understand money is often tight. But the difference between me and him is I'm not going to get on social media and beg for a free stereo receiver or whatever because I don't have the financial means to buy it. Now, over the years, people have been very generous to me in giving me things, both material things and helping me out with advice and such. And for that, I will forever be grateful towards those people. It means a lot that people think that much of me. But as far as me actually getting on a platform and begging for stuff, no, I'm not going to do that. The way I see it, if I can't afford to buy something, then it just won't be obtained. We'll just make do with what we have. You know, yeah, there are a lot of pieces of vintage equipment that I would love to have, but it's just not in my budget. And that's just the end of that. We'll just make do with what we've got, and I'll be thankful that I've got it. And if the time comes that it's ever in my budget, or if I happen to luck up on a good deal on something, then we'll worry about that then. We'll deal with that then. But no, getting on social media or wherever and begging for something, that's just, I just wasn't raised to do that. And I'm not going to do that. You know, it seems like in today's world, when you run a little bit short on cash, just open a GoFundMe page and beg people for money. And I mean, I understand extenuating circumstances come up, deaths, health reasons, whatever. I get that, but you know, to get on social media or to open up a GoFundMe page and beg people for money to cover for your poor decisions because you drank up all the money and now you have no money to pay the light bill, then that kind of crap I don't go for. And personally, I'll try to help people whenever I can, as long as I think you're truly in need and not trying to pull a scam or not coming across like you're entitled to something. It's like back whenever I was fixing televisions, and every now and then, I'll tell you one case in particular. My sister was working for a church that had an outreach ministry, and one day she called me and says, I've got a lady here that's a burnout victim. We're trying to help her, but she needs a television. And I told her that, you know, we normally don't hand out televisions because that's not something that we consider to be an essential item, but I've got a brother who fixes TVs, picks up used TVs and fixes them. I'll run it past him and see if he's got something. So she called me and I said, yeah, go ahead and give her my number. I'll talk to her and see if I can help her out with something. So a little while later, the lady called me. And she's telling me her tale of woe about her house burned down and she's trying to start over and she doesn't have anything and blah, blah, blah. And she needs a TV. And then she starts, and then she continues to tell me, oh, and I need it to be at least 27 inch, have cable ready tuning, remote control, and AV input jacks on the back. And back then, that's when such a set was worth something. Flat screens were not a thought yet, and her attitude just really didn't sit well with me. And I said to myself, well, lady, if you're in a position to tell me what exactly you need, then you're in a position to pay for it. So I said, okay, I've got exactly what you need. The price is $225. And needless to say, that was the end of her. I never heard another peep out of her. Now, had she kept her mouth shut, she could have got the TV for free. But, you know, when you come across like that, I really don't have time to talk to you. If I was down and out and didn't have anything, and if someone gave me a 9-inch black and white TV, I would be grateful to them. Now, on the flip side of that, about 20 years ago, the neighbors across the street, their son was going to church with a lady who had just left an abusive situation. I think her her husband was a real piece of work. He drank and beat up on the wife and kids, and she got a belly full of it and got out with pretty much nothing but the clothes on her back and the clothes her kids were wearing. And I think between her father and a lot of members of the church, they got her a place to stay, but she needed no furniture and a TV, something for the kids to watch. Well, we had an old hide-a-bed couch that we had been trying to sell. There was nothing at all wrong with it. In fact, it hadn't been used that much, but it was one of those deals where everybody wanted a brand new sofa for $10, and you know, once they saw it was 30 years old, they weren't interested in it. So I said, well, the heck with that noise. I'd rather give it to somebody who really needs it and can get some use out of it. So I gave her that in a 25-inch Zenith table model TV. It was one of those early to mid-80s sets in the big wooden box that you could screw the legs on it to make it into a console. Only I didn't have the legs. It was one of those kind of sets like what the schools used to have on the big roll-around carts. I don't think it was remote control. I don't remember. I think it had the pull-on volume knob, and then it had a green LED channel readout. So they came and picked that stuff up, and they were very happy to get it. I didn't catch any attitude like it wasn't good enough for them. And then I heard 6 months later that the TV was still working great and they were still watching it. Now, people like that, I don't mind helping, but when you're supposedly down and out and come across high and mighty, then I just really don't have a lot to say to you. Well, I've got plenty to say to you, but you probably wouldn't want to hear it. All right, enough rambling on about money and GoFundMe accounts and stuff like that. Let's start getting some more capacitors in this radio. Okay, go out of focus. Hold on. That's better. Yeah, this is an old Sprague capacitor. I don't think I've ever seen that logo before. And back in the mid-30s, I'm sure these were the cat's meow, but not that great today. Now, the later Sprague capacitors, like from the 60s on up, those are generally bulletproof. In fact, I see a lot of 1960s Sprague Atom capacitors that still work just fine and test just fine, and I generally leave them alone when they test okay. Let's test this one and see how leaky it is. Any value? Any capacitance value? Yeah, we got a little eye-opening there, but not as well-defined as we would want. Very, very, very leaky. Even on the lowest setting, very leaky. Basically shorted. So you have 1010 and 1390 are both running the same gospel programming. And both stations are owned by different people and cover the same area. And when the gospel programming goes off, then 1010 will switch to carrying Fox Sports, which is also carried on another station owned by another individual that has basically the same coverage area. So I think this is just a case of 1010 just grabbing a hold of whatever programming they can get the cheapest just to fill up the time, with no regard to the fact that, you know, another station's carrying this program. We need to carry something different. No, they're not even thinking about that.
Me now in this tree. See what it's like.
See, there
to
we
be
are
under
on 1390.
Who does not.
Okay, what happened? There's the black gospel station. You know, when I hear AM programming like this, from this is all that's available here, it kind of makes me wonder, why do I even bother fixing up these old things? You know, if it wasn't for nighttime programming and the in-house transmitter that once in a blue moon turn on. Wouldn't be no need for this. All right, two problems off camera here that I encountered. I was going to replace this final paper capacitor, but as you can see, it grounds to the chassis on a little tab right there, and you can see what all's in the way, this coil here. You see a nut right there that holds the coil onto this bracket, but here's the problem. They didn't think to drill a hole through the chassis here to stick a nut driver through there. Instead, I would have to tear this switch out, this coil assembly out, disturb everything in order to get this out, in order to access that nut to remove it from the bracket and get it out of the way, and I'm just not going there. These coils tend to be fragile. Sometimes you disturb the lead dress, things end up happening that you don't want to happen, and I'm just not willing to go there. So what I did was, is we connected the replacement cap, and I don't even know what value this capacitor is, because we've already determined the schematic I have is obviously not for this chassis. I could not see a value on this capacitor down here. I checked it with my little handheld meter, and it read 0.047. However, I'm considering that to be an overachiever status, because this capacitor is likely leaky and fooling the meter into thinking it's a 0.047, so I guess it's really not an overachiever. So I just stuck a 0.01 in there, and instead of grounding it here, I ran it over to this ground tab and called it a day, and the radio seems to work. Second problem, this electrolytic capacitor. I was going to replace that. It read high ESR, and you know I really don't like sticking a replacement capacitor across an original one, because the original one could short and cause problems. Now I think this is one of the old wet types. Now had it been completely open, I would have probably just slapped a new one across it and been done with it. So I decided I was going to disconnect all five things connected to that positive terminal of the cap, put a terminal strip on the chassis and do it that way. And I decided to, in order to do that, maybe I needed to raise the temperature on my soldering iron. Well, we have this Hayco soldering station that was a very generous gift from a viewer a couple of years ago, back whenever I was having problems with the crappy modern Weller soldering station, and it's been set to 750 since the day I got it. Well, I decided I wanted to move it up to about 850, and I could get it to go up to 850, and then it would run back down to 750, and nothing I did was having any effect on that. And in fact, even at 750, after all that, it seemed like the tip was actually cooler than it was before. So I just did a factory reset on it, and we're going to see if it works better now. As far as soldering stations, for those of you that don't remember, the one before it was a new Weller that had a digital control on it. It just had a temperature up and down button, which is all I needed. That one didn't last no time before the handle came apart. It was held together with some kind of potting material. I was able to epoxy it back together, and it lasted a little while before it broke again. And then I fixed it for a second time, and we did this a couple more times. And then the thing just finally got so it wouldn't heat. And by that time, I just finally got disgusted and threw it in the trash. The Weller before that was probably about 20 years old, and it still had a knob style temperature adjustment on it. I have no complaints with that one. I got 20 years out of it. Whenever I was taking electronics at the community college in the late 90s, early 2000s, they had some old Weller stations there that probably dated back to 1965 when the college opened, and those still worked fine, but I think once Weller got bought out by Cooper Tools in roughly about 1970, I think that's when the downward spiral began. And then whenever they got bought out by the Apex Group, which was the name that was on that cheap, but well, it wasn't so cheap, it was just cheaply made, that last soldering station I had, the quality really went to pot. In fact, I was so disgusted after my last experience with Weller that I made up my mind that I will never buy a new Weller product again. Now, if I find something 50 years old that's a Weller product, then yeah, I won't have any issues with that, but I will never buy a new Weller anything again. Ever. Never, ever. You can just forget it. Well, since I was having so much trouble with the temperature, seemed like not wanting to do right on this new iron, I did something that I talk about people for doing. I finally got all the old wires loose from this capacitor, and I just bundled everything up and stuck it to the new capacitor like this, and then soldered the ground right here. Like I said, not the proper way to do it, a way I actually condemn, but when this soldering iron didn't seem like it was getting hot enough, I was doing it the only way I could. Now that I went and read how to do a factory reset on it, we'll check it and see if it's hot enough to do what we need to do. All right, we got it in here. This isn't too much better than the capacitor dangling around, but at least we have a terminal strip now. I need to replace the tips on both my big Craftsman gun and my little Weller gun. The tips on both of them are shot, so I either need to get some proper tips or make some out of a big heavy-duty piece of solid copper wire. I have in the past soldered terminal strips to a chassis using this Hayco soldering station that you see, but it's not a quick process. And doing the factory reset on it seemed to brought the temperature back. I was able to get it stuck to the chassis, but it's not that nice looking. But I'm not worrying. We're not restoring this radio. We're repairing it. So there you go. Now let's get everything hooked back up and see if by some minor miracle it still plays. Now, like I said, this capacitor here, it's just going to have to hang loose, because I can't get out in there to get it out, and I'm not going to risk damaging this antenna coil to get it out. So like I said, it can just hang loose. I'm not worried about it. And if anybody else is worried about it, then just remember, you're not the one here fighting with it. I am. Okay, is it going to play, or are we going to have more foul-ups?
You also got a bad information there. So you need to get in to figure out what part of the world of finance you want to go
amazing.
Into. And then figure out what that pays, and figure out a way to get in that. And maybe if you want to work, maybe the new job in the world of finance will pay for it.
I can't believe it.
I would do it. But I'm going to, you know, this is like you've got cold feet where you are.
Now, I think the next order of business is to come up with a speaker and an output transformer.
Education do I need?
And then we will do an alignment on this.
Education a little bit differently than we used.
And then we will put it back together. Now, as far as a power supply, I could build a battery supply, or we could build an AC supply. Really, this one, it's not really practical to build a battery power supply, because the cost of batteries these days, for one thing. The other day I went in the I was at Walmart looking for 9-volt batteries, and I wasn't going to pay $14 or $12 or whatever it was for a 2-pack. So I went to the dollar store, and even the batteries that used to be there for 89 cents are like $3 a piece now. And I used to buy like $10 store batteries to make up the 90-volt batteries for the 90-volt and 1.5-volt farm radios. This radio here would take, 15 batteries to come up with 135 volts? So yeah, 15 9-volt batteries to come up with the the 135 volts. We'd need a 2-volt battery for the tube filaments, and that would have to be something fairly high capacity because these things draw a lot of amperage. Maybe we'll measure that before we're done, see how many amps the filament chain is drawing in this radio, but we'd have to come up with a 2-volt battery for that, and then we'd need 22.5 volts, which would require, well, we could use 3 9-volt batteries to give us 27 volts, or we could use a couple of 9-volt batteries to give us 18 volts plus 3, say, AA batteries added to that. That would give us close to 22.5. Then we'd need the 4.5 volts, so 3 more AA batteries for this 4.5-volt C voltage. The C supply doesn't really draw enough current to amount to anything. The B supply is not that bad. The filament supply, however, that's a different story. But at any rate, in order to power this thing from batteries would be very costly, and you wouldn't have much play time before at least your filament battery ran dead. So I think for what I would spend on making a battery pack, it probably wouldn't take much more to build an AC supply, and I could run this thing off of the wall socket. Just out of curiosity, let's see if we can get anything on shortwave. Maybe not. I don't know. We'll try a little later after. We'll try a little later, but shortwave, I'm not overly concerned about. It's getting so about all that's on there is stuff in Spanish and reruns of Brother Stair, and I don't really care anything about listening to either one. There was one station playing oldies on shortwave. I think they were out of Tennessee. I don't even know if they're still a thing or not.
22 football season. Jacqueline and Tim Hogan are big supporters of Mississippi State Athletics.
Now, if this radio was a true restoration, I would have taken the time to restuff every capacitor. I would have cut open this electrolytic capacitor very carefully and stuffed it with a new one, and then carefully epoxied it back together where it couldn't be seen. We'd use period correct terminals on the battery cable here. We'd search out and find a period correct reed type magnetic speaker like what was in here. But like I said, this is not a high value radio. The cabinet's fair. I mean, it's presentable, but it's not pristine.
Center, the pinnacle.
And you don't want me to try to refinish a cabinet. It would
mark it.
It would look worse than it does now, but
patented.
This was more of a get it playing, and that's what we've done, and that's all we're going to worry about.
Remotes and aero folding, the Pinnacle SL600 is a smooth, stable ride while maintaining your independence. Queen City Medical Equipment, 1423 23rd Avenue in Meridian, or call them at 6167.
You have a hospice recommendation from your doctor. You need the best help available. Harper's Hospice Care is a local staff of hospice professionals.
I just tuned across the shortwave band again off camera with the volume wide open, and I'm not hearing anything that even sounds like shortwave is working. Now, that could be a faulty band switch. It could be a faulty coil. The winding on one of these coils that has to do with shortwave might be open. I'm not worrying about it. I don't care. Like I said, there's nothing on shortwave that's really worth a crap anymore, and I'm just not stressing myself over it. I start digging in it trying to find out why the short wave won't work, and I'm liable to kill the standard broadcast band. So all we're going to do to this is align it, find a proper speaker and output transformer for it, slide this thing back in the box,
I work for a
and that's
company,
it. And what do you know? I got the offending capacitor out that we had hanging out. I was able to get the soldering iron back down in there. And with it back up to normal temperature, I was able to heat the connection. And thank goodness whoever built this radio didn't do it like most everybody else did. On this particular radio, they more or less ran the component leads through the respective connection. They didn't bend anything over or crimp anything or nothing. They just ran it through there and soldered it, and that was that. Now, that makes it real easy for replacement purposes and removing components. Had they bent this around and crimped it, I wouldn't have got it out so easily, but I was able to get my iron down in there, and I don't think I touched anything that I didn't need to touch. I was able to heat it up, grab the capacitor from the other end with the pliers, and pull it out. Now let's see what value it is. Well, it looks like it is a 0.01. So that was a pretty lucky guess on my part. Yep, 0.01 indeed. Alright, I'm going to check the voltages on the oscillator and mixer tube on standard broadcast versus shortwave and see if we can figure out what's going on here. And I notice a lot of people on these radios refer to these as having the AM and shortwave band. Well, that's really not really all that correct, because technically both bands are AM on these radios. It's just a more accurate description would be the standard broadcast band and the shortwave band. The standard broadcast band is what we're hearing right now from roughly 535 to 1710 kilocycles. The band above 1710 kilocycles is a shortwave. All right, our plate voltage is 130. That's about right, and it stays at 130 regardless of what band we're on. Here's our G2 reading 88 volts on the standard broadcast band. And even with this high impedance meter, it's loading it down enough to kill reception. What do we have on the shortwave band? We drop down considerably to about 40 volts. That doesn't really seem right, does it? And it looks like our current went up a little bit. We're on shortwave now. Back to AM. There I went and did it. Okay, standard broadcast, shortwave. You can tell the current went up just a tad bit there. So we have something shorted loading us down here. All right, here's our G3, which is our negative 6.8 volts that tells us the local oscillator is running. Let's flip it shortwave, and that jumps to 48-49 volts. Woo, something is... We've got something shorted here somewhere. Alright, reading from G2 to G3 in the standard broadcast mode, I read 65k ohms, there about 66k. Now when we flip it to shortwave, I read about 1.7 ohms. So that's not good. We've got something crossed here somewhere. Something is shorted. Well, the good thing is that condition doesn't really sound like an open coil causing that. It sounds like a short in this switch assembly somewhere. Maybe a piece of debris or something got down in there and is shorting the contacts. I don't know. Let's try to find out. Well, who knows? Maybe I'll have to get this switch out after all to figure out what's going on, and if I do, then maybe I can put this capacitor over here correctly. Well, now between G2 and G3 on standard broadcast, I'm reading almost 300k ohms. And on shortwave, the survey says 'it was trying to read shorted again, or was it this auto-ranging meter acting stupid? All right, we put the switch back in, and now we read 4.8 ohms in shortwave mode, and ...79K in standard broadcast mode. Interesting. I suppose since we're going to have to pull this out anyway, I can go ahead and put this capacitor back where it's supposed to be. Wait a minute, what's this? We had this capacitor lead, our lead going from somewhere, going down here and touching one of these other terminals. So, is this of my own making? It could very well be. Let's get rid of that lead. That may be the lead off of the old capacitor. That looks too old, and it would be too long for what was on this new capacitor. So we're going to whack that off. We're going to try to switch this other capacitor over here to this ground lug where it was originally. Then we're going to put all this back in and see if the short went away. It's fun trying to hold the chassis in a certain position with both hands, or propping it up on whatever you can prop it up on and solder the connection at the same time. But those of you who have worked on these things in the past, I'm sure can relate to that. Well, hot diggity dog, we got it where it originally was. So that's good. Now let's put the switch and coil assembly back in and connect it back up and make sure this wire is completely out of the way and not touching anything before I want to test it before I cut it off. And I want to see if this laying down here on one of these other terminals is what fouled up our shortwave operation.
Voting.
Well, standard broadcast is still working. That's good.
We get a vote. Okay.
Let's see what shortwave does. I have an idea. It's not doing anything. Whoop, it is doing something. So apparently that was the problem. This wire that I overlooked was touching something and shorting out the switch. All right, good.
Even then, listen, this is one of those things that he needs to let go of. And so, yeah, you need to sit down there.
Who knows, that wire could have been a boo-boo from the factory that they'd forgot to cut off, and just in the course of me working on it, I moved it to a point where it shorted out to something and caused our problem, but we're going to get rid of it right now. Okay, that should just about conclude the under chassis work. So now we need to come up with a proper speaker and perform an alignment on this, and it ought to be ready to go. I think most of what I did was pretty neat, except for this right here, and I don't need you to tell me this is a bit sloppy. I know it's sloppy. What I need to do is dig out my two soldering guns and get the tips taken care of on them, because something like this is really not meant to be used to solder something to a chassis. Yes, I've soldered terminal strips to later, like 1950s and 60s record player chassis and all that kind of stuff, but the metal on those is a lot thinner than this stuff is, and it's easier to solder to. This thicker chassis material, like from the 1930s, you need a good bit more heat to do an effective job. Now, I don't think this is going anywhere, but it would look a little bit better had I had the proper gun ready to go. You know, a 200, 250 watt gun is a lot better than a 60 watt soldering station. Like I said, this was never meant to solder things to a chassis. I mean, back when these radios were new and technicians were working on them, pretty much all they had was big guns, big soldering guns, and that's what they worked on these with. Personally, I've gotten so used to working on sets with a soldering pencil type iron here, it would be kind of hard for me to do chassis work with a gun, especially given the tight quarters involved with some of this stuff. And my solder better hurry up and get here, because you see my spool is rapidly depleting. And would you believe there's not even a place locally that I could go get solder? Back in the day, we had an not that long ago, within the past couple of years, it was during COVID when they shut down, we had an electronic supply house that I could just run in and pick up stuff like this. Solder, desoldering braid, heat shrink tubing, stuff like that, contact cleaner. I'd pretty much given up on buying resistors and capacitors from them, because for what they wanted for one film capacitor, I could order a whole bunch of them from Mauser for a lot less money. Now, I get supporting local businesses, but I also have to look out after my pocketbook. I always jokingly said the $2.99 capacitor at the local parts house, you know, I was paying $2.49 for the packaging that it came in, and 50 cents for the capacitor itself. But back in the day, the parts house and the stereo video store were two separate entities. The older guy on the parts house, his son and his wife pretty much ran the stereo and video store. And the older guy told me not long before he died that back in the day, radio and TV repair was his bread and butter. But he said, now if I had to depend on radio and TV repair, I'd go belly up. He said, you're about the only one that comes in here buying parts for radios and TVs anymore. He said the commercial accounts, such as schools and hospitals, are what keeps me going. Well, when the old guy died, the son had the bright idea to close down the parts house and combine that with the stereo and video store. And it just never was the same after that. I mean, back in the day, I was going in there several times a week buying parts. But then as the TV repair thing sort of winded down and that sort of thing, I found myself going in there less and less. And when they moved in with the stereo video store, I was doing good to go in there maybe two or three times a year. And then one day during COVID, they just abruptly, one morning, put a sign on the door that said, we are closed and we will not be reopening. So, you know, we have no place to buy any kind of electronic parts or supplies now. And the battery's dead. Nice. All right, we have the other camera. Now, this is not the same camera that I used for years. This is actually one just like it. Now, what happened, another very generous viewer gave me a newer camera after the one I had crapped out, and then a friend happened to have a camera just exactly like the one I had that crapped out, wanted to know if I wanted it, so I took it, and I just keep it around for backup and, you know, fill in stuff where I can film something when the battery's charging on the other camera, etc. And I just want to do a quick little band scan and kind of see where we are before alignment and see if I can get that oldie station on shortwave.
It's 10 minutes now before you...
We are getting some DX on AM. But we still got a few thunderstorms in that area, so that's going to present a problem. All right, there's 910 coming in at about 890, so that's a little off. And this camera just don't want to focus for nothing. One of the issues we had with the other one, too, the one I...
Investor, that's Ramsey.
Yeah, it goes into focus, and then it goes out of focus. What happened? What happened to my... What happened? Why did we go dead? What the heck's going on here?
First 30 days will focus on
loose wire on my test speaker there.
The next 30 days will focus on humility financially.
I give up.
The online store at Ramsey
Solutions. We're just going to have to deal with a blurry image because I can't get this thing to focus.
Their last nine runs via the home run.
Emergency. Information network.
Then we get the Black Lives Matter station.
These are challenging times.
Oh, you're actually going to focus this time? Yeah, we're on the short wave, bottom end of the band. Let's see what we can get.
My grace. It's in favor of God is given to mankind.
Just the short window of time from the time I met Dr. Scott.
I mean, how long have you been? It's been several times.
Alexander Scorby reading the Bible
on
shortwave. It sort of sounded like it. You know, he's the one that read was a narrator for the Talking Book program. For the visually impaired for decades, and the Bible was one of his more noteworthy works. Sideband, a ham radio operator. But like I figured they'd be, most of them are either religious or foreign language. I gotta make it quick because the memory card in this camera is not nearly as large as the one in the good camera. This one's only good for about 8 minutes. I can get about 47 minutes on the other camera. And we're down to about 3 minutes left on this one, so.
And change me and all that, it has nothing to do.
Outside of his. There's WWV. I was wondering where you were. Oh, that sounds entertaining. Hoping I could find that station that plays oldies, but at least you do have a little bit more shortwave, gives you a little bit more than just the standard broadcast band, if you can find a station that turns you on. I think that station that played oldies, I think they ran a little bit of everything. I think some religious programming in the daylight hours, and then after dark they played oldies.
No. He wants to leave his human race.
In the stillness of the night,
I got to think that's WWL 870 out of New Orleans.
855-2124. U.S. Tax Shield, 800-687-5192. 92.9 FM, ESPN, Memphis' official back-to-school sports station. No cap, sure, you picked out...
All right, that's probably 680.
Have you picked out your favorite back-to-school radio station?
I remember in the early 90s when they played an oldies format, and then they switched to R&B, but they couldn't really compete with WDIA, and then they went to talk and then sports.
On your smart speakers, just...
All right, WSM, where are you? All right, there it is, peeking in very faintly. But we've just got too much noise and too much thunderstorm activity for this to really do a whole lot, but at least we're getting it. And that's not bad, considering this hasn't been aligned yet. Now, here's the R&B station out of Baton Rouge. It decided to fade out just as soon as I engaged the camera.
Storms likely again tomorrow, 76. For Thursday, sunshine.
KSGF, wherever that is. I'll have to check that. All right, there it comes back in. We'll just leave you with that tonight. All right. It's another day. We're out here in the shop with the back on the good camera. We have the signal generator fired up, and we're going to let it warm up for about 30 minutes, and then we're going to try to align this thing. Now, I was reading over the instructions for the provided schematic, and they advise you to do the IF alignment, and if the radio works satisfactorily, don't go any further. However, if you need to align the dial tracking, do that, and then check short wave, and they strongly advise to leave the short wave alignment alone unless it's way out of whack. All right, I don't know where there's supposed to be two on each can. I don't know where the other one is unless it's on the bottom. Well, that got that one louder. So let's turn our output down and do this other one. And then I'll try to find the... This is not going to get it. We may just have to get this thing. You need a plastic tool for this, but these trimmers are so jacked up, they're so stiff, you can't turn them with a plastic tool. Well, that got it a little loud. I'm just having to do this trial and error. All right, back the other way. I'm about to the point of who cares if the IF's dead on. You're going to get the same crap on here no matter how well it's aligned. Okay, on this one I discovered the screw adjusts one trimmer and the nut adjusts the other trimmer. So let's turn it down some more. And is there a nut on this one? Yes, there is. Can I turn it? Yeah, maybe if I had a non-conductive tool to do it with. And the kind of tools you need to align these things, they don't even make anymore. Hold on, I'm going to do this off camera. Well, the schematic shows a third IF transformer with just a single trimmer on it. I'm not seeing that on this set. So like I said, we're probably just going to get this as good as we can, and we have it better than what it was, and we're just going to let it go. Okay, as far as dial tracking, I believe this trimmer does the low end of the dial. The trimmer on the tuning condenser does the high end of the dial. The ones on the tuning condenser are having absolutely zero effect on this, and I'm not worrying about it. Like I said, it is what it is. And the only difference this thing being in perfect alignment is going to make is, rather than get the sludge programming from right here in my area, you'll get a couple of weak sludge programming stations from 90 miles away, and I'm just not concerned with it. Okay, I tweaked on these tremors on the tuning condenser, finally got them to respond. I cannot get this dial to track right for anything in the world. I even took the glass off and realigned the pointer, got it as close as I could, and it just will not track right. I can get it to track at the high end of the dial, and then it's off at the low end. I can get it somewhat right at the low end, but then it's off at the high end. But I did get the sensitivity up. And there's that station out of Jackson, Mississippi, about 90 miles away. And quite frankly, I'm not going to worry anymore about the dial tracking. It's so small, I can't hardly see it anyway. I'm more worried about sensitivity than I am dial accuracy.
Game Thursday against Chicago.
Yeah, I think that's what he's saying.
There's the little country station coming in very weakly with the volume turned all the way up. Let's see if I can, since that's a weak station, let's try to alright, that's about as good as that gets.
Cowboys had
Philadelphia 11-4 winners over Cincinnati. Atlanta shut out the Mets.
This thing is loud.
San Diego 3, the Cubs 7-5 winners over Washington. St. Louis. Designer, designer.
Now, now.
I hear something faintly there. That's probably 940. And that's about it. So I'm really getting about all I would expect to get at this time of day. The only thing I'm not getting is 670. It seems like these radios are often less sensitive at the bottom end of the dial than they are at the top, so let's turn on the yacht boy and see if it'll bring in 670. 670, enter. Yeah, the yacht boy is bringing it in.
Saturday at 11:30 a.m. for the Tabernacle of Witness Gospel Hour.
But this tube set is not even touching it. But let's see if the yacht boy will bring in 1490. 1490. All right. What's the station out of Jackson? 1190. Well, that was 11:30 I punched in. No wonder I'm not getting anything. Okay, I've about done all I can do to this. The service information describes adjustments that don't appear to be on this chassis, but it's like we've already discussed. This just schematic is different than what this radio is. The sensitivity on the high end of the band appears to be nice. The sensitivity on the low end of the band appears to be crap, and that's just the way it is. I can't do anything about that. The only thing is, I might not be able to get WSM at night. We will try that after the sun goes down. At least we can get 1490, although not great. But I think I'm about to the point of trying to locate a speaker and getting an output transformer and shoving this thing back in the box. Alright, shortwave is still working. Although this is daytime, we're not going to get as much. He's all over the place, isn't he?
Cause or influence to creep.
But like I said, it's getting to the point that's about all you're going to hear on shortwave is stuff like what you just heard in foreign language, and that's it. Like Shango has talked about before, with the internet being what it is today, that has really put a damper on shortwave because they don't really need to maintain a high power transmitter that's an electricity hog. They can just get it out over the internet for a lot cheaper. Now, yes, there are still a lot of people without internet access, but in the grand scheme of things, there's probably more people in today's world who have it than don't. So that's the reason a lot of the shortwave stations have gone away.
Gospel 01-422-0910. We're Praise 95.9 FM.
Could you play something by Mahalia Jackson or Sister Rosetta Thorpe from the 78 RPM era? Do you even know what a 78 is?
Inflation is real. The CPI is at another 40-year high.
Okay, we'll come back out after sunset and crank this thing up again and see what kind of reception we get. That'll tell the real story, but my Grundig Yacht Boy seems to be more sensitive at the lower end of the dial. It's bringing in 670, pretty good. This one here is more sensitive at the high end of the dial, and it won't even touch 670. This power supply originally for the bias supply had a Zener diode and then a potentiometer wired across the output as a voltage divider, so you could set it to get the voltage you needed up to 22.5 volts. Well, I think I've already mentioned that a lot of these radios require more than one bias voltage. So I cobbled together a voltage divider here using a couple of resistors to get me the 4.5 volts without having to rely on that battery. Well, I get 22.5 volts unloaded here, but whenever I turn the radio on, that drops down to 14 volts. And then we get about 10 volts here, so I need to play with this some more, but the radio is a bit distorted, and I think that would not be the case if we had this bias supply up to what it needed to be. But the radio just puts too much of a strain on this and loads it down. This bias supply needs to be beefier. And whenever I, probably what I need to do to modify this is, instead of using a simple Zener diode, and I even took that out of the circuit, and that didn't raise the voltage any, but instead of using a Zener diode regulator, we need to make that bias supply more beefy and have it regulated with like an LM317T or whatever it is, the same regulator we use for the filament supply. And we need to have at least two of those so I can have at least two negative bias voltages.
Mainly because it was a...
Alright, I just found a speaker on eBay, a PM speaker that we can probably make work. And I went ahead and ordered the Hammond transformer from Antique Electronics Supply. I won't be able to get the impedance right at 10K, but I can either get it in the 8K or the 11K range using an 8-ohm speaker. Of course, that's not exact, but it should still work. You know, these tubes are not that fussy. As long as we can get it in the 8 to 11K range, I think it should probably be fine. And once we get our bias voltage what it's supposed to be, I think everything will be okay. Okay, I removed my voltage divider because doing so brought my bias voltage from 14 up to 16 volts. I realize that's not much. And then I went back to my 3-volt battery here, which formerly we had about 10 volts there, and my audio is clearer now.
Him being a presence alone.
So we're just going to leave it like that for a while.
Really super high football IQ.
Now, when I remove my 3-volt bias, we get a little louder and it gets very distorted. And in this case, our 3 volts or 4.5 volts, as the tag calls for, negative grid bias voltage, connects to the center tap of the interstage transformer. It comes around right here and through the center tap to that transformer. And then the outer leg of that winding, one outer leg, goes to the control grid of one section of the output tube, and then the other end of the winding goes to the control grid of the other section of the output tube, and that's what provides your that 3 volts or 4.5 volts, whatever you want to feed it with. That's what provides your negative grid bias for the audio output tube there. I'm going to look around, see if I can find another battery to put in series with this. Even if it's a AA battery, that's fine. And bring this up to 4.5 volts, which is what is specified. And I just want to see if any improvement or imperformance is noted. Or we might notice a lack of performance.
All right, we've
now got our... 4.5 volts with another battery wired in series there. Our 22 volts is a little lacking though. It's down to about 16 volts. Now, like I've said before, this will sound better once we get the proper impedance. This transformer and this signal tracer is not meant to give the best possible performance under any chassis that it's connected to. It's meant for testing purposes, just to see if the chassis is passing a signal, and
test the positive P and E's after
it is passing a signal, obviously. You know, I'm pretty sure the impedance of the transformer in this more closely matches that of like a 50L6 or 6V6 or something like that. So we're just going to wait, and when we get the speaker and the universal output transformer, we'll connect everything up, and I think it'll sound even better than it sounds now. I mean, it's not horrible now, but I think it will sound a bit better, a little less distorted, and may have a little more volume.
The Padres possibly know what Tatis puts in his body every day.
But this thing gets super loud. In the 22 volt, bias comes in here to one end of this can-on resistor, and then we have a couple of bias takeoff points here, and then the other end of the can-on resistor connects to ground, which is the chassis. So this is just a voltage divider here, and one of our bias takeoff points goes down to, where does it go down to? Well, it looks like it connects to this one pin on this voltage regulator tube, which I think they're just using that as a tie pin. And then we connect to this 1 mega ohm resistor that's up to like 1.3, 1.4 meg. And then it connects to the control grid of the second audio tube. So that provides bias voltage for that tube, and then this bias takeoff point right here at this point connects to this resistor, which looks to be also a 1 mega ohm, and it goes down to the front end stages of the radio. So measuring across this can-on resistor, we read 7.3K. So yeah, that's the reason our 22 volts is getting loaded down just a little bit. If this was a little bit more robust, this bias supply, it would not do that. And whenever I construct a bench power supply for the purpose of powering these kind of radios, I'll keep that in mind.
NFL games.
All right, just to make things right, I have two power supplies connected in series and adjusted to give us 22 volts for the 22 volt line here. And then, of course, our 4.5 volts from the battery. Now, this 4.5 volt line draws basically no current. Obviously, we have a little current draw on this other thing with the way this is set up. Roughly a 7K resistor voltage divider across the power supply there. Okay, well, it's a shame I found this towards the end of our little adventure here, but I was in the right book, just the wrong page. A little more digging, and I don't know how I missed this the first time, but with a little more digging, I found the proper schematic here. 7735, 7742, and 7755. And this looks more like what we need here. And turning the page, we have the alignment procedure for this radio, which is fairly detailed and is a different procedure than the way I was doing it. So perhaps if we go back through this and do it correctly according to this procedure, maybe I can get everything to line up properly. As you can see, we have our A plus, which is the heater voltage that goes up through this ballast tube and then goes to all the other tubes. That's 2 volts. Here's our 4.5 volt negative C voltage that goes up to the center tap of the secondary winding of the audio interstage transformer, which, like I said, provides negative grid voltage for the push-pull output tube. And then we go down here and we have our negative 22.5 volt C voltage, which, like we've already determined, goes through this voltage divider with a takeoff point that goes up here, providing negative grid voltage for the audio driver tube. And then we have another takeoff point here that provides negative grid voltage for our first audio tube. And the other tubes also benefit from that voltage. And then what else do we have here? We have our B plus 135 volts here. That of course provides voltage to the rest of the radio. This is very small. I'm going to have to put this under my closed circuit magnifier to really read this. And then, of course, our A-minus connection and our B-minus and C-plus connection, which all is switched to chassis ground there. Yeah, this looks better. I just wished I'd have found this before now. Now, what threw me off was when I first looked this up on the Radio Museum site, it took me to the model 77A, which was the erroneous schematic that I was looking at, or erroneous for the set that we were working on. And then I done some more looking and found these other two model numbers, 77, 55, and 42. And I realized that they corresponded to 7735, all the same schematic, probably just different cabinet variations. Well, on Nostalgia Air, they didn't show me a 7735, but they showed me a 55. And I looked on that. And Radio Museum also has a scan of the schematic, but it's pretty lousy. It's almost unusable. Nostalgia Air is a little better, but since I had the original copy here that's the best, I decided to go with this, even though we're going to have to put it under my magnifier to see it. Before we reattempt an alignment, I was looking at the parts list, and they specify these Domino capacitors as being Micromold brand. Well, I'm here to tell you, now there's one here, one here, probably some somewhere else, one right there. A lot of those are not really mica capacitors, despite what the brand of the capacitor might imply. A lot of those are actually paper capacitors in a brown bakelite domino style casing, and those are known to be very leaky if they're paper capacitors. So I want to pull those loose and check them and make sure. Because if we have one in the front end that is indeed a paper capacitor and is jacked up, that could throw off our alignment and make it impossible to get the desired results. Okay, I have one end of this cap loose. This is the one that connects between the plates of the output tube. So one end still has a high DC voltage. The end that's loose only has 0.7 volts on it. That's really not that terribly bad, but that's still a bit positive there. Alright, 0005, which translates into 500 picofarad. Alright, this one's a Polymet brand. It's got a good eye opening. Let's check it for leakage. Okay, this one seems to be fine. So, yeah, that I think is an artifact of my tester. Let's unhook it and see if the flashing remains the same. Then we'll know that it's the tester. And the flashing remains the same. Actually, if you'll notice, just with my ground probe on the chassis, I get a little registration on the meter here, and just for fun, I tacked in one end of a new 500 picofarad cap in, and let's see what we get. About what we got on the other one. So, yeah, there's nothing wrong with that capacitor we took out, and that's likely a genuine mica capacitor. Not saying that mica capacitors never fail, but the genuine mica capacitors usually remain good. So if you find one that's still good, it's probably going to remain good. So, you know, you can leave it in the circuit. Now, if we look here on the parts list, there's a 0.003 microfarad mica mold. Now, that's one I'm really interested in, because usually capacitors 0.001 and above are going to be paper capacitors. Although that's not a hard and fast rule, but I want to find that one and see where it is and check it. It says that's number, 1374? So let's try to find that on the schematic. Alright, that appears to be it right here, a 0.003 microfarad in parallel with a 15K resistor with one end connected to the oscillator coil. So if that one was hosed up, then that could very well be bad. That could very well be throwing our alignment off. And I believe that's it right here. So we're going to get it out, check it, and replace as needed. Now this 003 capacitor is also just fine, so it's going back in there, but in order for me to effectively check it, I had to cut one end of the resistor loose. It wasn't wanting to come unsoldered very easy. The resistor's 15K, it checks 17K, that's fine, that's within, well, that may be a little bit out of tolerance. So now that resistor's within tolerance. As long as it's no more than 18K or any less than 12K, we're in business. If I can connect this back up, we will. If we can't, I'll just replace it. Okay, we were able to save our resistor. Now some might say, just go ahead and replace that. No, I'm not going to replace it because it's a mica capacitor, evidently. And it tests perfectly fine. And the reason we're not, expanding on the answer to that question as to why we're not going to replace this. Generally, when a mica capacitor is used, especially when it comes to the tuned circuits of a radio, they're using that value of capacitor because it's a better precision made, tighter tolerance than a standard paper capacitor, and these don't drift like some other types of capacitors do. So when they need a very tight tolerance and something that's stable that won't drift, as in a tuned circuit, this is why you use a mica capacitor. And in a lot of cases, these capacitors are hand-picked for a particular circuit. So even if I replace this with another 0.003 microfarad mica capacitor, then that new capacitor might be off just enough to throw things off, whereas this one here would not throw things off. So, and if I were to replace this with a standard film capacitor or disc capacitor or whatever, then its tolerance might be wider than what was in here originally, and that could throw things off, or the capacitor could drift as the set heated up, and it wouldn't have to drift much, just a tad bit, and that would throw things off. So now that we've confirmed this is good, we'll put it back in the radio. But with it being a 0.003, I just wanted to pull it out and make sure that it was not a paper capacitor hiding in a mica case and was leaky. Alright, that capacitor's back in place, and I'm not going to worry about the other one or two in here. I think we've determined that these are all micas and that the set seems to be working okay, so I think we can proceed with the realignment of this radio, and we're going to follow the instructions precisely. And before we even get into this, we're going to determine what every tremor is. There's 1, 2, 3, 4 tremors under the chassis. Of course, the 2 tremors in each IF can, and then there are 2 tremors on the tuning capacitor. There are several things that have to be tweaked here. So the first thing we'll do is turn the signal generator on. Let it warm up for about 30 minutes to stabilize. Same goes for the radio, and then we will put it to it.
Talk about buying a house.
Okay, in this particular set, they tell us to disconnect the grid cap of the oscillator and mixer tube and connect the high side of the generator directly to the grid cap of the tube with the tuning condenser turned to the top end of the dial. And our generator needs to be set to 465. So that's one mistake I made. I didn't disconnect the top cap of the tube here. Usually they don't want us to do that. We may have to do this with the cap on because the tube is loose in its base. The cap is stuck like Chuck to the tube. And I'm pretty sure I don't have a replacement tube, and I don't want to destroy this tube. So we have a 0.002 microfarad cap in series with a signal generator to the top cap of the tube to prevent the signal generator from loading down the front end of the radio. I have the signal generator and the radio cranked to max, and I'm getting very little out of my test speaker here. So yeah, this alignment's jacked, all because of my own doing. You know, I did it to 456 based on the other alignment instructions. This one tells us to do it to 465. And I also have the antenna disconnected to prevent any signal pickup. So let's see. What is that? A piece of insulation? Better try to get that out. Okay, let's turn the output down. Way down. Now I need to find something to adjust this hex nut around here. All right, not an approved alignment tool here, but all right, let's turn it down. Want to keep the signal generator output as low as possible to prevent AVC action, and that which would cause you erroneous readings. So we're going to continue to turn this. I don't even think they make the fiber non-conductive tools to adjust these anymore. All right, there's that one. Turn it down a little more. And we will tweak this inner screw again. Now, if you remember when we adjusted this one with a metal screw, it caused all kind of hum and interference, so that's going to have to be a trial and error thing. See what I mean? And like I said before, these screws are so tight that adjusting them with a plastic tool is out of the question. And of course, I don't have a non-conductive hex tool here, so. Oh yeah. Turn that down. Now let's try to adjust the inner thing here. Or is this one a quarter inch? I was thinking one of these was a quarter inch, while the other one is probably something like a 5/16. No, they're both, I guess, the same size. Remember, it was this morning whenever I first aligned this. I've eaten lunch and done several things since this morning, so. All right, turn her down. Yeah, let me do this off camera and try to get this peaked as best I can. I think that got the IFs peaked. Now just for the fun of it, we're gonna disconnect all this and connect the outside antenna and see what we get. I'm already hearing what sounds like distant stations trying to come through, and I don't even have the outdoor antenna connected. Now, of course, I know having the signal generator connected could have something to do with that. Well, there's Baton Rouge coming in. What is our, 910's coming in way off now. Ought to be coming in about right there. It's coming in about 10:30 there. Well, I believe it's raining outside, so I guess I better get up before it really falls out. And it's getting kind of late anyway, so let's go up and we will continue this alignment tomorrow. All right, we now have the signal generator and radio set to 15 megacycles and tuned to the shortwave band as per the instructions here. And now they want us to adjust the oscillator section of the tuning condenser for maximum output. Okay. Well, it sounds like we're not getting anywhere, does it? Well, it seems my signal generator needs to be calibrated on those higher frequencies. And since 15 meg is WWV, I had to move this down to 14 meg to get an accurate thing. And I just set the signal generator dial until I got a clear signal into the Grundig here. So we're going to do this one on 14 meg instead of 15. Yeah, one day I need to open this thing up and calibrate it, and with that Grundig receiver that's digitally tuned, I can more easily do that. Alright, that's about as good as that's going to get. Okay, I managed to get this set to 1500 based on the Grundig Yacht Boys, so we redid this to 1500 as per the instructions. Now what do we need to do? Now they want us to set the generator and the receiver to 1400 KC, and that's going to be a little difficult since we have a powerful station at 1390. We may have to choose another frequency there. Now we adjust this tremor to get maximum. I have it set to 1420 KC. Generator down. Come on, get in there. There we go. Now what? Now they want us to set the generator and the receiver to 1720 kilocycles, which is the top of the dial. And if that frequency cannot be received, they want us to readjust this tremor until it can be received. Right now we need to adjust this tremor again to bring in 1720 kilocycles. And why is that not happening? Crank the generator up a little bit. Let's see if that'll do it. Oh yeah. Now they want us to put the receiver back to 1400, or in our case 1420. And then adjust the RF tremor on the tuning condenser for maximum output. Although turning this screw didn't really change much, now they want us to set everything to 600 and adjust this tremor through the front of the chassis for maximum sensitivity. Alright, here's the tremor in the front that they talked about. Yeah, I'd say that woke it up some. About right there. Alright, I'm going to go back through off camera and go through the procedure again. It's better, but it's still not where it needs to be. But as jacked as this alignment was, it's probably going to be necessary to go back to it two or three different times. And I think when I might have said 1500 KC earlier, I meant 15,000 KC or 15 megacycles for the short wave. So yeah, let me go back through this again, and we'll do this over and get it as tight as I can get it. Alright, 1450 is coming in about where it should be on the dial. As is 1390. There's the station out of Jackson. That's pretty good.
This country depends on your vote. Don't you dare say. Don't you? I'm just one.
That's 10-10. That's pretty close to where it's supposed to be.
Don't you dare stay home on election day.
That's 9-10, about where it's supposed to be. And this thing is still not touching 670. Yeah, the Grundig's picking it up with ease. But the Coronado won't even touch it. And I figure part of the reason for that is there's so much noise on the AM broadcast band that the more modern receiver is more equipped to filter out. But this one here just picks up all the noise. There's no kind of filtering, and the noise is like a jammer.
This is what they do. This is what the FBI has done. What they've done.
Right, talking about the.
All right, there's a station out of Jackson. It's coming in a little better than it did pre-alignment.
One. Seattle defeat.
Interesting.
There's the country station.
Thank you.
Not really good enough that I can listen to it with any kind of enjoyability, but I hear shortwave. Oh, I'm going the wrong way. Yeah, not much here either, and yes, again, the Grundig is superior on short wave over this set. As bad as I hate to say that, the Grundig was picking up WWV on 15. This one won't even touch it. But I'm about done with this, except for changing the speaker and the output transformer when those items show up, but you know, it is what it is. This one doesn't have an RF amp stage. The Grundig does, so they could have a lot to do with it. All right, I'm outside with the Grundig, away from some of the noise in the building. We know it'll bring in 670, whereas the other one won't. Let's try 1490. It's not even touching 1490. So in that respect, Coronado has this one beat. All right, I'm hearing it a little bit now as I move. All right, I'm hearing it a little better after moving the radio close to the outdoor antenna, but still nothing great. All right, let's try 1190. Isn't that the Jackson station? Okay, 1180, not 1190. and it's bringing that in probably about as good as the Coronado, or maybe a little better. And here's WWV at 15 on the Grundig, and the other receiver apparently won't even touch it. About all it'll pick up right now is Brother Stair on about 10 different stations. Well, our solder came in today. This spool got a little mangled up, but no big deal. The other two seem to be okay, and it seems to be decent enough solder. And yeah, I paid for what it would have cost me to buy one spool of 1 pound solder from places like Antique Electronics Supply. I was able to buy 3 spools from somebody on eBay that just happened to have it. And I always look for deals, you know, when I can find them. And like I said, this stuff is getting terribly expensive, and we have no local parts house anymore we can buy this stuff, so I have to get it when I can. So 3 spools of solder, 3 pounds worth, that ought to last me a while. Now I tweaked the RF tremor on the tinning condenser, and 1450 is coming in slightly better now. But the low end of this receiver is pretty lackluster, and like I said, I think a lot of the interference is to blame for that, and these older receivers are not capable of dealing with that as well as more upscale modern receivers like the Grundig. Back when this was made, the types of electrical noise we have today were not really an issue, especially when you consider these battery-operated farm receivers were way out in the boonies, away from any type of electrical interference anyway. And back then, because there was not as much electrical interference, a small power station, something like a 250-watt station, would go a lot further than a 250-watt station today would go. With all the interference and junk we got today, it might take a 1,000-watt station or a 10,000-watt station to be able to do what to overpower all the noise and be able to do what a 250-watt station could do back when this radio was made.
How much more are you?
Sounds like we have the late Alexander Scorby on shortwave again.
Taking thought can add to his stature 1 cubit.
I was reading up on him, and I believe he passed away in 1985, but before that he was very involved in the talking book program for the visually impaired. The Bible was his most famous reading, but he read many, many books over the decades from the 1930s up until the time of his passing, for the visually impaired talking book program.
And seek not ye what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, neither be...
Well, I'm getting this on several different stations. But I'll tell you this, I can deal with that type of gospel music better than I can what I'm hearing on some of the mainstream gospel radio stations in today's world. Yeah, I'll come down here after dark and we'll give it a workout and see what it can really do.
Why'd you wait?
And another thing about this radio, it has pretty broad tuning.
So,
in other words, it's not very selective. If this were in areas where you had 2 stations right on top of each other, the advantage to this arrangement is better fidelity. But like I just said, if you're in an area where you've got 2 stations on top of each other, it probably not going to be the most selective radio in the world, but back when this radio was made, that was not so much of an issue.
See,
be like the shepherd.
And not really that big of an issue in today's world, unless you live in an area that has a very crowded AM band, and that's getting to be less common, as a lot of AM stations seem to be dropping like flies these days.
Actually, text me, Scott. You've probably...
Here's that tremor capacitor that we don't know what its purpose is, and they don't even mention it in the alignment instructions. It comes off of the bottom of the secondary winding of the second IF transformer, as you can see there. And it has what looks like a 1 meg resistor in parallel with it. And then the other end of that tremor goes over here to the signal input side of the volume control, which also connects to the bottom end of the second IF transformer. That's where the detected audio goes into the volume control here. So I really don't know what that's for, unless that's some kind of a trap. I tried adjusting it. It didn't really make any difference, so I just put it back where I found it. And yeah, looking at this schematic, this does not have a dual IF stage like I originally thought. Dummy me for not paying attention and paying too much attention to that other schematic that was actually wrong. This is basically about the equivalent of a 5-tube radio, so, you know, its performance is about what I would expect it to be. And we have our oscillator and mixer tube here. If you'll focus, hold on. All right, modulator and oscillator. It goes into our first IF transformer, then our IF amplifier tube, which goes into our second IF transformer. And the output of that goes into the AVC and detector tube here. And then the output of that goes into the volume control and then into the first audio tube, and then the audio driver tube, and then that stage is transformer coupled to the push-pull output stage. So yeah, the extra tubes in this set are basically for audio duty. But like I said, basically this is going to have about the sensitivity of your average 5-tube set. So I guess on that note, that's not too terribly bad, really. When nighttime comes and I can get some stations at the lower end of the band, we may play with that RF tremor on the tuning condenser to sort of align the tuning condenser. The sensitivity will be equal throughout the band instead of hotter on the top end of the band than it is on the bottom end. We just have to play with that. Alright, it's about 5 after 8. About dark outside, and we have a country station here at the top end of the dial, probably that one out of Monroe, Louisiana. Sounds like another country station. Maybe another country station.
What is the short, the answer to the question? All working together.
15 million to Cal. Because you left.
Just sit here.
Another essential black film. A Day in the Life of a Chicago Barbershop is the basic plot of 2003's Barbershop. Ice Cube is Calvin, the owner who wants to sell the place. And does, but he learns how to see.
That's probably the Baton Rouge station.
Within the FBI. And that.
So it's a vanity issue. Oh, rồi mua xe mới cũng chờ rất là lâu.
All of a sudden, she's got a wild hair up her.
Clearly, the typical millionaire in the first.
Nothing like me, dude.
initially, you know, I came out with
probably 870 WWL. There is just so much noise on the lower end of the band. We're just not getting much of anything here on the lower end. Let's go for short wave now.
Currently we are, the believers are called virgins.
There's no consequences. Let me tell you something, friend. There is a consequence. The consequences of me sitting here and getting angry are not. The consequence is going to be between you and God. You
would the Palestinians cost? In support of the food stamps.
Finally, WWV is coming in on this thing at what about? I can't even half see this thing. About, I don't know, 8.5. I don't know. Like I said, I can't even hardly see this thing. There it is again. I think that should be coming in on 10. So yeah, that's a little off.
Antes reiteramos titulares.
Okay, there it is again at 15. That's pretty close. And that's it. Alright, there's WSM 650 just barely coming in, but there's so much noise that it's just drowning it out. And I'm wondering where that noise is coming from. I'm wondering if it's something in this power supply, like noise from the Zener diodes here. When I build one of these, we're probably not going to regulate the B plus with solid state devices. I'm just going to use a voltage divider or dropping resistors and do it that way. It's really not that critical. The main voltage that needs to be regulated is the filament voltage, and even the old school battery eliminators didn't do that. They built those older battery eliminators to provide the proper filament voltage based on the pre-calculated load that it was anticipated that would be placed on the battery eliminator by the radio, and that's just the way it was back then.
6:30 and mention singing news when you call.
This is probably 1090 KAAY, Little Rock, Arkansas. And they're supposed to be turning off their nighttime power. Well, not turning it completely off, but going from 50,000 watts down to something like 80 watts. I don't know if that's happened yet. If it has happened, then we're extremely lucky to be bringing them in tonight. Trying to see if we can catch a station ID here.
Since 1981, they've satisfied billions in eligible medical bills for hundreds of thousands of Christians. Through resources like the Prayers Unceasing program, I've been able to pray for my fellow Christians' prayer requests and send them cards of encouragement, and I know they would do the same for me.
PHM is the longest-serving biblical solution to your healthcare call.
Well, we're going to say that.
Visit chministries.org to learn more. chministries.org.
Gospel music, there's one event you cannot miss. In fact, it's the world's largest Christian music festival. This summer, Christian Healthcare Ministries and Abraham Productions present 40 days and 40 nights of gospel music at the Ark Encounter in Williamstown, Kentucky. Over 120...
And you just want to scream...
In case I forgot to mention it, I found out that this radio was actually made by Sentinel in Chicago, not Belmont, like I originally had thought, but I do know that Belmont made some radios for Gamble's department store.
So go to Ramsey's.
It's about 5:20 in the afternoon, and I'm not really hearing anything interesting. It's not quite late enough for that yet. WWV did peek in a couple of times briefly on 15 megacycles, but it faded out pretty quick.
Start today.
About all I'm getting on shortwave right now is two or three different religious stations that are broadcasting on several different frequencies and some foreign language stuff, mainly Spanish, and that's about it. I haven't found the oldies on shortwave yet. They might have done away with that. That may no longer be a.
Can I really afford that car repair?
That may no longer be available.
You shouldn't have to.
And of course, we all know that AM, and I use that term very broadly to mean standard broadcast and shortwave, is really going down the toilet. And with AM capabilities being deleted from a lot of modern car radios, that's really gonna hammer the nail in the coffin for AM radio, since most of the radio listening is done in cars. And if AM is not offered as an option in a lot of the new cars, then people obviously won't be able to hear it. So if people are not able to hear it, then that's not gonna paint a pretty picture for AM broadcasting. I feel like the reason a lot of stations are even hanging on to their AMs is because the FCC is requiring them to do so in order to keep their little low-powered FM translator. If the FCC told them that you could shut your AM down and still keep the FM, we would probably be seeing a lot of AMs going silent. In my area, there's only one AM station that doesn't have an FM translator, and you're listening to it right now. And I don't see them ever getting an FM translator. I mean, from what I gather, they're barely hanging on as it is. So I don't think an FM translator is going to be in the budget. But the other stations,
so this month we're bringing,
you can hear them on FM, and I suspect the only time people listen to the AM side is when they're in a location where the FM may be difficult to receive, and the AM can be received.
John Deloney, questions for human cards by...
It's about 20 minutes to 7 in the afternoon, and this is 1610 out of, I believe, Pensacola, Florida.
It's still unclear why the warrant, why the raid, as the national anger boils over.
On News Radio 92.3, informative, local, dependable.
Got the incandescent light on to... so we can actually see with the fluorescent light off, so we don't have all the interference, or not as much interference. And that's a talk station, that's just bumper music. Don't know what this is, playing Steve Miller Band, maybe more bumper music. Let's find out. Now, whatever it is, it's fading into oblivion, so we may not get to find out. You think the copyright detection will pick up on that?
Show locked on the front.
1932. AM 1010. WMOX.
Lower this time of day. Here's some jazz playing on shortwave. I have no idea what station. Possibly Radio Miami International, maybe. All right, I found the oldies. 7 point something. I don't know if that's the station out of Florida or Tennessee. But from what I've found with these shortwave stations that play oldies, their selection is a better variety than the crap you hear on your typical good time oldies FM station. Yep, so the oldies is still on the air. So that's a motivator for me to pick up radios with the shortwave band on them. It may not be what it was 30 or 40 years ago, but at least we do have a little more variety there with the shortwave band. And I guess they're not going to give us a station ID, but I just about bet the farm that that's KAAY.
But I'm not waiting a year. Thanks, Dave.
Local bank can provide. That's the spirit of First America. Mm-hmm.
ISM continues to get a little bit stronger as the night progresses. I don't think this is so much a case of a radio that has a dead low end. I think it's just a case of some external noise being introduced that's wiping everything out on the low end. There's Baton Rouge coming in fairly decent right now, but it'll fade out pretty soon, I'm sure. Yep, there it goes a little bit. You still are some decent AM stations around, just unfortunately none of them in my area.
Not as much as that, but you know, that's what you shouldn't be on TV as bad as it was.
There's that country station up at the top of the band and the extended band. By about 9 o'clock, WSM will probably be coming in a lot better, although I'm not going to hang around down here that long. I just wanted to make sure that it would receive it, and it does. And by the way, I am not going to build the power supply for this radio during this particular video series. This has already gone on a long time, and I don't want to, that'll be another video in itself. All I've got left for this video is to get the speaker and the output transformer installed when those items show up, put it all back in the cabinet, and we'll be done with this. I think this is 690 Catholic Radio out of New Orleans. It was formerly the old WTIX AM spot. I don't know what the call sign is today, but that's pretty impressive for that to be coming in. And I've received it several times here. WSM.
Welcome to the Car Pro Show.
Jerry Reynolds is the Car Pro.
Well, hello, Jerry.
And no matter what kind of vehicle you're looking for, he can help you.
What is it, WOAI?
You spend $70,000 on a car, I wouldn't let resale value be a consideration. They're all going to be fine, resale-wise. Get the one that you like, get the one you want. It doesn't matter if a car's got good resale value if you don't like it.
The Car Pro Show with Jerry Reynolds. Straight talk and honest answers about everything on the line.
Yep, that's it. That station usually comes in.
With Russian President Vladimir Putin, given that most of the matters discussed would require the Kremlin's agreement. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis on Thursday and
points for Rob Parker. You ready, Fred?
You'll be with me.
All your devices with the iHeartRadio app.
Rams
Emergency Solutions. On the debt-free stage, Jeremy and Becky are with us. How are you?
Hi, Dave. Good.
Our dear friend, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. WSM is coming and going, but I think given this radio doesn't have an RF amp stage or an additional IF stage, and it's probably working about as good as it's capable of working, and given all the external noise we have, then that's also a negative factor. I think if it wasn't for all the external noise we have, we could probably be picking up a lot more on here, but the noise is just acting like a jammer and just trampling all over the weaker signals. Alright, that's about all I've got for the radio for now. The next thing you'll see is me installing the speaker and output transformer, and then this thing will be finished. And made in Canada. You don't see that much on parts anymore. Usually it's made in China. So we have our center tapped secondary with the red going to B plus, and then the other two connecting to each tube plate, and then we have our multi-tapped secondary winding here. We have our transformer. It just arrived. Nice little Hammond 5-watt transformer with a frequency response of 100 hertz to 30 kilohertz, which is ample enough for the radio. Looks like it was made the 27th week of 2022. Made in Canada. You don't see that much anymore. Usually it's made in China on parts these days. As you can see, we have our center tapped primary winding with the red connecting to B plus and the other two connecting to the tube plates. And then we have our multi-tapped secondary winding, which based on the impedance of the speaker you use and based on which tap on the winding you use will determine the primary impedance, because whatever load the impedance is you put on the secondary will be reflected back to the primary impedance. In other words, whatever loads you put on the secondary is going to affect the primary impedance here. And if we look on the box, they give us this nice little table here to show you what connections to use for the desired impedance. So first we'll find the impedance of the speaker being used, and I don't have the speaker in hand yet. It would have been nice had it shown up today, but no such luck. But we're going to be using an 8-ohm speaker, and we need to have a primary impedance of about 10k ohms. Notice I said about, but as you can see on the list, it does not list an exact 10k ohm figure. We can either go 11,600 ohms or 8,200 ohms. But like I said, about 10k, I think either one of those would probably work satisfactorily. So if we went the 11600 route, we would connect the speaker voice coil to wires 1 and 4 on the secondary. And if we went the 8200 route, we would use wires 2 and 5 on the secondary. And those wires are so marked here on the transformer. Now, if you wind up with one of these transformers in a box of junk that's not in the original packaging, that same information I just showed you is available on the internet, so you can find that without too much trouble. We don't have our speaker yet, but we can connect this to the radio and connect it to a temporary speaker and see how it's going to sound. All right, here's a 6x9 speaker out of a mid-70s lower-end Zenith console stereo. It was one of those deals where I had the stereo fixed up and ready to sell and got tired of all the BS trying to sell it, so I just wrecked it for parts and threw the cabinet out to the street for the trash. The DC resistance is 14.6 ohms, so this would be considered most likely a 16-ohm speaker. You can kind of get a ballpark of your speaker impedance with a standard ohm meter reading, but to get a more accurate reading, you would need an impedance, an audio impedance tester that will check the impedance of things like speaker voice coils and audio output transformers and such at a given frequency, usually around 1 kilohertz. That's generally, in the old days, that's how these speakers were rated, is in speaker impedance 3.2 ohms at 1 kilohertz, etc. All right, so we have a 16-ohm speaker. So we're going to look on our chart here and see what we can find close to that. Actually, come on, focus. Actually, this is 15-ohm, but yeah. All right, 21... 10,200, that's pretty dadgum close. So what wires do we connect to? Wires 1 and 5. Alright, let's crank her up and see what happens. Well, I'm hearing static. Tune it to a...
Meyer and Rosenbaum, now located at 1901 Front Street, historic downtown Meridian. Talk Radio, AM 1010, WMOX, Meridian. USA Radio News with Tim Berg.
UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres is...
Yep, that seems to work pretty good.
Amid Russia's ongoing invasion of the country, Guterres explaining the importance of allowing ships to travel through the Black Sea.
Getting more food and fertilizer out of Ukraine and Russia.
As you can see, like I've already explained, this does not have very sharp tuning.
The United States is expected.
What's this mess business of taking old secular songs and redoing them into gospel songs? What's up with that?
So no matter what can be done, matter of fact, it has been.
Early this year, deepening now, with home sales in July falling for a sixth straight month. The National Association of Realtors says sales fell 20.2% from July last year.
If not my favorite segment of the week. Well, you watched it. Hopefully Justin Fields took the field last night.
And of course, once we get a speaker inside of the cabinet, that will also tailor the sound of this.
Through six, what they've done since he's been drafted. So they draft him. In the second round that year, they draft a tackle.
This speaker, I think the voice coil might be dragging in it a little bit.
Guard. Also in year one, they tweak quarterback one.
At low volume, it's kind of got that raspy
quarterback controversy.
That raspy sound when the cone is warped a little bit and the voice coil is rubbing against the pole piece.
Then they fire the offensive coach. And then they let their best receiver go in free agency. How they could not afford him is beyond any grasp, considering they don't have many great players. Allen Robinson, now a Ram. They lie.
Organization. It should be noted, no evidence of any...
OG Meridian and Trace 95.9 FM W240 TY, where Meridian's only gospel radio station and Meridian's gospel connection. Trace 95.9 FM 9:10 AM.
Oh. It's working. Okay, little change of plan. This is what we're going to do here. I junked out a school phonograph that has a 6x9 speaker in it. And as you can tell, I drilled two holes in the mounting board so I could mount the board to the front of the radio. And I had to modify the board just a little bit because these bolts were not quite long enough. I don't want them to be too long out the back because I don't want them to protrude through the speaker cone. But I believe we can just screw the speaker onto this board and then mount the output transformer to this board and everything will be hunky-dory. And I mean, yes, there'll still be plenty enough room there for the sound to escape. Well, I just noticed, drilled my hole was a little off there, but yeah, I'm not a woodworker, have never professed to be. And this is really going to be temporary because if I ever find the correct type of reed type magnetic speaker that goes in here, I'm going to pull this out and put this speaker somewhere else and put the reed correct speaker back in here. In most cases, these classroom record player speakers are riveted to the speaker mounting board. In this case, that the speaker was screwed in. And I'm really thankful for that. It made my job a lot easier. And it also makes me wonder if possibly that speaker had been replaced before. I think this is probably one of the few that I've seen that was screwed in. Like I said, most of them were riveted in place. Now I need to find a couple of wood screws to mount this transformer up here. And I'm not going to sever these wires, or at least not close enough to render them useless, because if I ever end up putting the right kind of speaker back in here, I may need this transformer for something else, and I want to keep all of my taps in place for other options that might be necessary. All right, transformer is physically mounted, and I've cut off all of the bare wire ends off of these taps, and we're just going to ball them up and put them out of the way. Like I said, I don't want to sever these off up close, because if I ever find the correct speaker for this, it's going to be converted back to like it originally was. And then I'm going to splice these on to the correct wires on the primary here and insulate them with heat shrink tubing. And then this will be good to go. And if I don't find another speaker, then what's in here will just stay. All right. We're all in place, and no, I don't need you to tell me that that's jake-legged. I know that it is. Like I said, I intend for this to only be temporary. I don't even have these leads insulated good because I was running short on heat shrink tubing. So we're about to connect the battery eliminator to this and hope that it works. Usually that's when they stop working after you're finished with them and you put them all back together. That's when they do something stupid and not work. All right, we're plugged in. Let's see if it works. Well, that's a good sign.
This is the Doug Gottlieb Show on Fox Sports Radio.
Oh, yeah.
What's a rivalry?
That's not a question I'm posing to you. That's the question that the NBA is.
By Discover, we could talk about how complicated other banks make it to redeem credit card rewards, or we could talk about how with Discover you can redeem your rewards for cash in any amount at any time. I mean, talk about amazing. Learn more at discover.com/redeem rewards. Terms apply.
This thing starts distorting at higher volumes.
We both really think
it gets loud, but you know, it's really not that good for a lot of power before we start getting into distortion. A lot of that might be cured once we get our bias voltage right. You might remember me telling you that this thing's loading down the 22 supply on this, knocking it down to about 14 or 15.
Relevant as they hope they are. The ball is now... has shown that expansion very likely...
But this thing probably has more bass with this speaker than it ever did with that Reed magnetic thing. But if I ever find the right one, we'll fix it back the way it was from the factory. Still no 670. Not much shortwave today. Oh, that's entertaining. Okay.
Hen perspective, but when you at the SEC.
And WMER, they're just so overpowered that it just throws this radio into oblivion. The road that once didn't make sense
now seem crystal clear. This deal. This was a really big deal because Kevin Warren's early tenure in the conference was not great.
Correct.
And that's an understatement considering how the conference handled the
COVID. All right, that's about all I've got for this radio. If you made it to the end, then congratulations. I know my videos here seem to be getting longer, and I think part of that is due because when I had the old camera, I was having to dump it about every 8 minutes, so that motivated me to keep things short and sweet. Well, on this one, I can go on for about 47 minutes between dumping, so I tend to ramble on, but I'll try to work on that in the future. I know you don't like seeing videos that are 2 or 3 hours long. And I know there's really no need in them being that long, really.
I had the reaction that you just brought up a second ago. You know your time ain't long
for. All right, what station are we tuned to?
How y'all doing?
Give us a call in the praise lines. And request your favorite gospel jam, 601-482-0910. We're Praise 95.9 FM and 910 AM.
Oh, well, here's why it was a bit distorted. Our 3-volt or 4.5-volt bias connection came loose. Okay, whatever. Now I plugged it in again with the bias battery connected this time, and it sounded like my distortion was even worse, like one half of the push-pull section wasn't working, so I clipped my own meter across the halves of the transformer, and I guess now it's not there. There it is. You can see where it's cutting in and out there like we have an intermittent connection here. Come on, do it again. Uh-huh, yeah, we have an intermittent connection here. And I'm trying to figure out where it is. Is it where I soldered them together up here? I was kind of doing this in the dark, so might not have done it that great. Or is it up here in this connection on the main plug that goes to the back of the radio? but you can see it going berserk now, and I'm starting to think it's in the plug here. Yeah, I'm gonna have to redo that plug. Right now I've got it making connections, but I'm gonna have to redo that. Probably just gonna go ahead and change the wire in it and be done with it. And when I bring the radio up here to operate it, we have modulation hum, which is a hum that's only present when it's tuned to a station. But we've gotten rid of a lot of that noise at the low end. Okay, I think we got rid of most of the distortion. Another mistake I had made, if you read from the center tap to the outer end of the secondary winding, they will not read equal. For example, one side reads like 120 something ohms, and the next side, other side, reads about 170 something ohms. I think that's something to do with the, I'm going to have to look into that and see exactly why they do it that way, but I know if you reverse those, that can cause problems, and I found out that I had those reversed, and when I reversed them back around, that seemed to have helped clear it up some. I'm also going to do this a little more professional this time. We're soldering our output transformer leads and our cable going to the radio to a terminal strip, which will be fastened on the speaker mounting board. And of course, then we'll have this cable clamped up there so it won't be able to move around. All right, there it is, clamped in, bolted in, soldered in. It ought to be ready to go. All right, I think the modulation hum is coming in on the filament line, which is also the cathode, because whenever I disconnect the filament, it briefly gets a little bit louder and clearer before it goes away, and the hum goes away too. So, and I'm back down here in the shop, and it's clear as a bell. No modulation hum, less distorted audio.
Control your behavior in financial peace.
Now we got this noise, and I'm going to check something. It does it with the lights turned off, doesn't it? Yes. I wonder if it could be the switching power supply and the air conditioner that's doing it. Well, it's not the air conditioner. I unplugged that, and the noise did not go away one bit. Lights, no help, no luck. So I don't know what it could be. All right, both the light and the air conditioner unplugged, still nothing. Well, I bypassed my AC power supply and it's nothing there doing it. It sounds like something arcing somewhere, but having a clue as to where it could be. Got our auto-tune gospel going on here. One thing I'm going to try, but not tonight, is I'm going to take it back up there where we have the modulation hum, and I'm going to connect a capacitor from one side of the AC power line to B minus, which is the chassis, and see if that will stop it. And it might also cut some of the interference that we're getting out here too. And here we got some talk radio from a DX station. Don't worry, I'm not going to bore you with 20 minutes of scanning the dial again tonight. Now, if we ran this on battery power 100%, We wouldn't have any of these problems, I don't believe, because we would be completely isolated from the AC power line. There would be no hum, no ripple, no nothing. And speaking of batteries, I think originally they probably meant for this thing to operate, if I haven't already said so. The filaments were probably meant to operate on two number six dry cells in series, and I believe those were made up until a few years ago. And then the B supply was designed to operate on three 45 volt batteries in series. And then the C supply was a 22.5 volt battery, and I think those generally had taps on them for lower C voltages, so there was probably a tap on there for 4.5 volts. So, but like I've said, trying to build a battery pack for this would really be impractical, and I think the heater draw, filament draw on this is around 630 something milliamps, so that's pretty hefty. You know, conventional modern day garden variety supermarket batteries would not last very long on this, especially for the A supply. And then here's the Black Lives Matter station again.
Her husband was away from home a lot, and she felt
a thunderstorm Sunday. From the Meridian's Good News Gospel Station Weather Center, I'm Joanna.
Hey friends, this is Matthew Browder with the Browder.
First place team. Complicated other banks make it to redeem credit card rewards.
Okay, about had enough of this one for now. Looks like we're not quite through yet. I would like to get to the bottom of that modulation hum and get that taken care of. Okay, we're back outside on the other outlet and we still have the modulation hum. I'm going to try jumping a capacitor from one side of the AC line to chassis.
Everybody out there again. About the legacy of
and see if that
Shannon
works.
Shannon.
I'm not going to try too hard here. If I can't get rid of it at the power supply end, I'm not going to worry about it. I was looking on eBay and I found some batteries that I can get online for a lot cheaper than what they would cost me at Walmart or any retail outlet, and that's what I may end up doing. But we're not going to do that in this video. If I go that route, I'll make another video as far as building a battery pack for this. That would be the ideal way to run this radio, because there will be no tie-in with the AC power line and there shouldn't be as much interference. Of course, the downside is you won't be able to play the radio a lot, because those batteries will not last long, especially the filament battery. Let's jump our capacitor to chassis and see what happens.
And he said, well, it doesn't matter. They're totally committed to bringing
hum went away.
Deshaun Watson. All right, let's say the 49ers do.
The hum went away. Okay, that got rid of the hum 100%. Now, for those who say that because this capacitor is used in a lot of AC powered sets with a power transformer, you'll have the capacitor connected between one side of the AC line and the chassis. And a lot of people say, oh, well, that capacitor don't serve any purpose. Just take it out of circuit. Well, yes, it does serve a purpose. And we just proved it right here. Without that capacitor, you could very well have modulation hum. So you need to replace that capacitor.
Last season, the playoffs of Jimmy Garoppolo, right? That's why they went to country with.
Still no 670, but I don't have a long wire antenna connected to this either. I just have the wire hanging out the back of the radio. And with my body acting as an antenna, I'm still getting the same noise that I was getting in the building with all the interference on the lower end of the band. So there we go.
however, then you have an insurance guy in Garoppolo. But let's say he sits on the bench, doesn't play at all, and that's
it. So that tells us that the interference is likely not being produced in my shop. It's somewhere else. It could be anywhere. It could be a combination of many things causing this. And there's probably nothing I can really do about it.
Is just okay, right? Like, can't round him or... doesn't scream, I need to sign Jimmy Garoppolo. Maybe he's a bridge and you don't want to stink for a season, but again, I've always been arguing.
All right, there you go. That's about all I've got for the Sentinel built Coronado. I'll say again, if you made it this far, then you're to be commended. And the future, I'll probably do a video on this, building a proper power supply and possibly a battery pack for this, but like I said, that'll come a lot later.